Good afternoon, everybody. We are now living in an unprecedented as well as unpleasant situation caused by the pandemic COVID-19. Due to the students are facing challenges as they are kept from attending usual classrooms. Also, a new syllabus has been juxtaposed with the introduction of course-based. Therefore, a huge change in the teaching learning process has been entered. Hence, a reorientation is essential for all the stakeholders, particularly for the students and the teachers. Supporting services like the service of library has also faced major rupture. So, as far as practical mind, we feel it is quite pertinent to host an enrichment program which can be beneficial for both the students and the teachers.
Good afternoon. It is a great pleasure for us to inform you that around 1,000 students and teachers have registered themselves as participants in our program. We have received response from almost everywhere of our country, literally from Kashmir to Kunyakumari. Besides various eminent colleges and universities, we have a large number of participants from other institutes like IITs and NITs also. We feel glad to inform you that participants from other countries have shown their interest also. On behalf of the organizing committee, we, the conveners of the program, welcome all the honorable dignitaries, eminent resource persons, the participants, and my colleagues. We welcome you all. Now, I have the privilege to request our chief patron, Professor Dr. Hori Prasad Sarkar, the honorable principal of our college, to inaugurate our program. Sir, please.
May I audible?
Yes, sir.
Audible, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. Good afternoon, everybody. It's a very proud moment for me to inaugurate and welcome to all in the 2 days webinar entitled Enrichment Program for Students and Teachers, First Phase, on Linear Algebra Analysis and Differential Equations, organized by Department of Mathematics, Kolkata College. This program was initially scheduled to be held on 1st and 2nd September, but due to sad demise of our Honorable former President of India, Mr. Pranab Mukherjee, we have deferred and also rescheduled the program to pay tribute to this great personality. Though this program is mainly organized to enrich our students and teachers, but it has immense value for the institution for future prospects. On behalf of Kolkata College and administration, I convey my best wishes and sincere thanks to all the faculty members of the Department of Mathematics, Kolkata College, and also the other persons who are directly or indirectly associated with this program, and also to all the participants from different institutions. I must heartily welcome and thanks to Professor Madhu Mangal Pal, Professor, Department of Applied Mathematics with Oceanology and Computer Programming, Kolkata University, and our honorable member of our governing body as VU nominee, for his kind consent to deliver his keynote address in this seminar. I also pay my sincere gratitude and thanks to 3 other erudite speakers in the webinar, Dr. Sujit Kumar Sardar, Professor, Department of Mathematics, Jadavpur University, Dr. Saurabh Das, Assistant Professor, Department of Mathematics, National Institute of Technology, Jamshedpur, and Dr. Vikas Chakraborty, Assistant Professor, Department of Mathematics, Ramkrishna Mission Vivekananda Centenary College, Rohora, for their kind participation. The mathematical sciences are part of nearly all aspects of everyday life, The discipline has underpinned such beneficial modern capabilities as internet search, medical imaging, computer animation, numerical weather prediction, and all types of digital communication. The mathematical sciences in 2025 examines the current state of the mathematical sciences and explores the changes needed to the discipline to be in a strong position and able to maximize its contribution to the nation in 2025. It finds the vitality of the discipline excellent and that it contributes in expanding ways to most areas of science and engineering and as well as to the nation as a whole and recommends that training for the future generations of mathematical scientists should be reassessed in the light of the increasingly cross-disciplinary nature of mathematical sciences. Hence, it is better termed as the queen of science. I hope that all the participants will be highly enriched from the valuable discussion of the different erudite speakers in this seminar. I wish the grand success of this webinar. Thank you all.
Am I audible?
Yes.
Sir, thanks a lot for your spirited words. It is really an appropriate prelude for our program. May I now request our departmental head, Professor Alarif Mulla, to say a few words about our department. Sir, please.
Welcome to all of the participants and dignitaries who are present in the webinar. Good afternoon to all. Since the inception of the college, the mathematics department has been working sincerely to spread the learning of sciences in this economically poor and academically backward area. At the very beginning of the last seven decades of the last century, that is 1970s, the college felt the necessity of opening honors degree in mathematics as the students were very eager to obtain knowledge in mathematical sciences as well as pure sciences. Realizing the continuous pressure and zeal of the local people and the college, Calcutta University as well as University Grand Commission granted affiliation of the most coveted mathematics honors course in 1974. This college is one of the oldest institutes for beginning the honors course in mathematics. The department has started its new journey from 2017 with a delightful feather on its crown as the postgraduate studies. One batch of MSc in mathematics have successfully passed out and one will be passed out very soon. One student has qualified the GATE examination. I also feel proud to mention that Dr. Abhijit Banerjee, Associate Professor of our department, has GST SAT project for 3 years on the topic quantum computing. The college central library has substantial number of books in both general and honors courses, where the number of mathematics textbook and reference books are beginning to increase notably every year. Now, the department is running well with the teacher and students, and the students admitted in this department are doing well in the university examination. Every year, some students successfully achieve the frontier rank in the competitive examination to pursue their higher studies in India's top few institutes, like IITs. Except very few, all the students passed out from this department have been placed in different government, private, public sector. Research journals, e-journals, and printed journals are subscribed by the department can be availed from the college library. There is a continuous research activity in this department, as well as ex-students are also in constant touch with this department in its perspective of higher studies and research. In view of emerging COVID-19 pandemic situation and subsequent lockdown, we all the teachers are still in constant touch with the students of UG and PG and taking classes online by Zoom, Google Meet, etc. I am thankful to the college authority for constant support and encouragement. Thanks to all.
Am I audible?
Yes.
Sir, thanks a lot for your thoughtful and informative speech. May I now request Dr. Prithish Kumar Haid, coordinator of IQAC of our college, to deliver his speech. Sir, please.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everybody. I, on behalf of Gaurvita College as well as IQAC Gaurvita College, welcome you all. Please allow me to start quoting Sir Albert Einstein. It was a talk to a group of children or students, and this talk was published in 1934. I quote, "Bear in mind that the wonderful things you learn in your schools are the work of many generations, produced by enthusiastic effort and infinite labor in every country of the world. All this is put into your hands as your inheritance in order that you may receive it, honor it, add to it, and one day faithfully hand it on to your children. Thus, do we mortals achieve immortality in the permanent things which we create in common," unquote. So he clearly insisted on shared prosperity of knowledge. He believed knowledge thrives in cooperation. In this era of digital revolution, what else could be the best example of such creation in common than algorithm? A person born in present-day Uzbekistan in the ancient province, Khwarizmi, who derived the name relating to his birthplace, Muhammad Ibn Musa al-Khwarizmi, who was director of House of Wisdom and intellectual center for scholars in the 19th century Baghdad, wrote a book based on the knowledge that was developed in our part of the world concerning the Hindu art of reckoning. 300 years later, this book was rediscovered and translated in Latin. Thus, the Western world got the taste of Hindu-Arabic numerals along with the decimal points. Since then, this number system prevailing upon. Al-Khwarizmi, whose book Al-Jabr is important landmark for algebra, became algorithmi in Latin. Though only in 19th century, algorithm finds its modern definition as a set of step-by-step rules for solving complex problems, but by the 13th century, it had become an English word as algorithm and used none other than by Chaucer. Then all of you know how a British Alan Turing showed how a machine could follow algorithmic instruction and could solve complex mathematics. And his machine that he built during the World War II called Bomb used algorithm to crack Enigma code. So knowledge evolves over space and time as a creation of common, and we must respect that tradition. I would like to thank Department of Mathematics for hosting a webinar where knowledge could be shared, and I would specially thank them for selecting as their primary beneficiary what I call them first stage unit of higher education, the students of UG, as well as this PG level, and their teachers. I urge upon the students here, you have the chance of learning, hearing from some of the best minds of mathematics. Do not estrange yourself from this opportunity if you desire to achieve immortality in permanent things which you can create in common in near future. I wish this enrichment program will be a grand success. I once again welcome you all. Thank you.
Sir, thanks a lot for your valuable words. I would like to now request Dr. Sushil Kumar Ghosh, PG coordinator of the Department of Mathematics, Gaurvita College, to take over from here. Sir, please.
Hello. Now it is a time to address this keynote speech. Now I have the privilege to introduce Dr. Madhu Mangal Pal, Professor, Department of Mathematics, Oceanology and Computer Programming, and GB member of our college as the keynote speaker of this webinar. Professor Madhumangal Pal is currently a professor of applied mathematics, Vidyasagar University. He has received gold and silver medals from Vidyasagar University for rank first and second in MSc and BSc examination respectively. He also received computer division medal from Institution of Engineers India in 1996 for best research work. In 2013, he has received Bharat Jyoti Award for the significant contribution in academic. Professor Pal has successfully guided 34 research scholars for PhD degree and has published more than 320 articles in international and national journals. His specialization include algorithm and fuzzy gap theory, fuzzy matrices, genetic algorithms, and parallel algorithms. Professor Pal is the author of 8 textbooks published from India and United Kingdom, and 2 edited books published by IGI Global USA. He has published 21 book chapters in several edited books. Professor Pal completed 3 research projects funded by UGC and DST, and 1 project is going on. Professor Pal is the editor-in-chief of Journal of Physical Sciences, published by Vidyasagar University, and Annals of Pure and Applied Mathematics, and area editor of International Journal of Computational Intelligence Systems, and member of editorial boards of many journals. Also, he has visited China, Greece, London, Taiwan, Malaysia, and many more countries to participate or deliver invited talks and to chair conference events. He is also a member of the American Mathematical Society, USA, Calcutta Mathematical Society, Advanced Discrete Mathematics and Application, Neurotropic Science International Society, USA, etc. Now I would like to request Professor Pal to deliver his keynote speech.
Thank you, Dr. Ghosh. May I audible?
Yes.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Thank you.
So, thanks to the organizer, particularly the principal of Gorbetha College, Dr. H.P. Sharkan, and Dr. Rajlokhi Mukherjee, Dr. Sushil Ghosh, Dr. Arif Molla, Dr. Abhijit Banerjee, and other faculty of the department. They are also my friends, for inviting me to this to deliver a keynote speech in this enhancement program. So I thank to them for organizing this series of lecture for the enhancement of the students and teacher for their benefit. And I think from this lecture or series of lectures, the students and teacher must be benefited. So I'll say few words and produce 2 problems, basic problem, very simple problem before you. So, you know, Shamiji told that je shikha samaje kono onno kaje lage na she shikha shikhay nai. So, je shikhar kotha uni bolechen jodio, but I can say that this is true for our mathematics also. So, you know that the mathematics is a very large subject, there is no doubt. We use mathematics every moment. Particularly from morning to getting bed. Every time we are using mathematics in our different aspect of life, you know the vegetable seller can calculate it very fast or can calculate arithmetic operators such as addition, multiplication, like that. Vegetable seller can do this arithmetic operation very fast. Sometimes it is more faster than us. So, he knows the first calculation of basic arithmetics, basic mathematics. And it is very interesting thing is that only 1% of the total mathematics, which is developed nowadays, only 1% of total mathematics is used to solve our real life problems. And remaining 99% mathematics are not used for the development of the society or development of the other things. So we are using 1%. So think, if 10% of the mathematics, at least 10% of the mathematics is used for the development of the society, then how much will improve our society? So our aim is to apply the mathematics for the development of the society. Otherwise, I think we are produce some papers or like that, it will publish in a good journal and there is no use for the society. So as if applied mathematician, I am a student of applied mathematics and teaching applied mathematics. So we can suggest we develop the mathematics or design the mathematics for the development of mathematics and for the development of the society. So this is my main aim to say our students or other teachers or our colleagues. So nowadays, mainly the engineers, management people, they are using the mathematics to solve the real life problems. So you know the mathematics are divided into two branches. We are generally saying that mathematics are of two main classes or categories. One is pure mathematics and other is applied mathematics. So obviously the pure mathematics is the foundation of our mathematics. Everybody or every student should know about the basic concept of the pure mathematics. Apart from this, other mathematical divisions are or categories are, say, discrete mathematics. It's also a very big chapter, discrete mathematics, computational mathematics. So computational mathematics are mainly used by the engineers. So computer scientists, mechanical engineers, electrical engineers, they use the computational mathematics to develop the real-life systems. So I am going to give some example for real-life systems. So computer scientists mainly use the computational mathematics in computer graphics. You know, the lot of pictures are in front of us. So this kind of webinar, a lot of pictures are there in our computer screen. So this is nothing but the computational geometry. The background of this display in the screen, entire screen, is nothing but the computational geometry. This is slightly different from our analytical or coordinate geometry. Many variants of coordinate geometry is that is computational geometry. And this mathematics is used to design the entire screen of the computer, or any graphics or any your computer games like this. So mathematics is used here. Also, the computer scientists use the mathematics in image processing, picture analysis, data science, machine learning, and many others. So these are the application, major application areas of mathematics or the applied mathematics in the our real life, to solve the real life problems. Recently, you know, the fuzzy mathematics gains high popularity due to its wide application in different branches of science and engineering. You know, the washing machine we are using, almost all people are using, the rich man or the middle class people are using the washing machine. So this is the first home appliances where the fuzzy logic is used. And that washing machine is designed by Japanese. You know, nowadays, we are using the luxury car, we are using rice cooker, we are using the other lot of home appliances. In every such home appliances, the fuzzy logic are used. But unfortunately, in the this part of the country, that is the east part of the country or the north part of the countries, very few number of people are working on fuzzy mathematics or fuzzy logic. So it has a lot of application in different branches of our science, engineering, even in medical sciences. But the South Indian people, huge number of South Indian people are working on fuzzy logic, and they have developed a lot of things on the aspects of fuzzy things. That means to handle the uncertainty. Fuzzy logic is basically used to handle the uncertainty. Probability, you know, the probability theories also handle or model the uncertain things. Similarly, the fuzzy logic is another subject or a parallel subject, and this subject handles the other kind of uncertainties. So this is the modern topics. We can say this is the modern topics for the research and as well as studies. So sometimes we see that we study a lot of things for a particular subject, a lot of problems we are solving for a particular topic. But if engineer asked something about your studies, then we can't give any answer. For example, after submission my PhD thesis, one engineer from IIT Kharagpur, they are asking me to solve and or to find the all roots of a polynomial equations. He asked me to give a method to find out all the roots of a polynomial. I am coming to discuss about that kind of problem. So this is our drawback. We are studying the many things, many properties, many example with the mathematician are investigating for a particular topic. But when an engineer asking us few other things, then we are not satisfied then. We have no answer to satisfy them basically. So I will present two problems before, very simple problems. This is an undergraduate problem, but I think it has some application or it has some way to thinking how we can apply our mathematics, the basic mathematics, to solve other kind of problem. Now I discuss two basic problems by introducing you a slide, presenting the slide. I have a small slide. Is it visible, this slide? Two basic problems of mathematics I have considered here. The college name is mentioned here, Kolkata College. So first I consider a solution of algebraic equation, very simple equation. Algebraic equation is basically a polynomial equation. So this is a linear equation. The first equation is linear equation, x plus b equal to 0, where a is non-zero. For a, b, x, it may be a real number or complex number, but a is a non-zero number. Obviously, the solution is x equal to minus b by a. Okay, it has certain group properties like that. Now we consider solution of quadratic equation. You know, this is the quadratic equation. Everybody knows it from class 10 or class 11. We are familiar with this equation, x squared plus bx plus c, that is it. And its solution, that means the roots of this equation, are given by this equation. Okay, so this is a very trivial problem, you know, from my school standard. So one simple question is, how we can calculate the square root of a number? What is the procedure to calculate the square root? So here square root is there, the square minus c, 4s, we assume that this is a positive quantity. So we have a, we can use the calculator to find out the square root, there is no problem. But there is another method, analytical method to find out the square root. We have learned it in a school level. No, say doubling the number like that. I forget the method at this moment. But we studied that method, how we can calculate the square root of 2, square root of 3. That is a big or complicated method. But there is another alternative method. That is based on iterative method, based on numerical method. So we can use this method to calculate. See that method, xn plus 1 equal to xn square plus d by 2 into xn. So using this formula, we can calculate the square root of d. It's a given real number, positive real number. So using this formula, we can repeatedly calculate the root. So what is the advantage of this formula? Or why I am producing you this formula? Because if you use the calculator, then there is no problem. We can determine the square root of a positive number. But without calculator, we can use this formula. There is another analytical formula which are studied in primary school or the class 5-6 like that. But apart from this, this is another formula. This formula, this kind of formula is used by computer. Xn square plus d by 2xn. This is based on our Newton-Raphson method. So what is the total arithmetic here? Xn square means, we have to multiply it by xn into xn. So one arithmetic expression, one multiplication, one addition, and by 2 into xn, one multiplication and one division. So there are four arithmetic operations, two multiplication, one addition, and one division. Okay. So using these four operations, we can find out a new xn. And if two xn are very close, xn and xn plus 1 are very close, then we can stop the method and we can find out the square root of the number. So this is a numerical method based on the Newton-Raphson method. And using this formula, we can find out the square root or any other root or any other power using the neutral absorption method. So this is the computer formula. When we are using the calculator or when we are using the computer to find out the square root of any other root, then the computer or calculator using the repeated formula, that is the numerical formula to find out the roots or any other. Okay. Now the solution of cubic equation, we know the any cubic equation, whatever may be the coefficient A, B, C, D, how much it is complicated, we can use the Cardan. The Cardan method is used roots, all roots of a cubic equation. But this third depends on quadratic equation. You remember that the Cardan method, from Cardan method, we construct a quadratic equation and find out the roots of quadratic equation, we can solve the original cubic equation. So this is a graph of third degree polynomial. There are three, see that this graph plotted at three points at the x-axis. So these are the roots, if the equation has the real roots. Now to solve the biquadratic equation, there are a lot of methods are available in our undergraduate books. For it is method, Descartes method, and there are three, four methods are available. Very simple methods, Fourier's method and other methods to solve biquadratic equation. Okay. So any biquadratic equation can be solved by Fourier's method, Descartes method, etc. But see that the Fourier's method depends on a third degree polynomial equation or algebraic equation. No. Carefully recall that the Fourier's method depends on a third degree equation. At the biquadratic, if you solve the biquadratic equation using Fourier's method, we have to convert this equation into a cubic equation. Certain rules are there. Fourier develops us rules to convert a biquadratic equation into a cubic equation, third degree equation. And third degree equation can be solved by Cardan equation, but the Cardan method depends on quadratic equation. That means the Cardan equation, basically Cardan converted the third degree equation into a quadratic equation. Then quadratic equation can be solved by that method. That method is sometimes we are saying that the Siddhar Acharya's formula, I don't know who developed that formula, but we are usually saying that that formula to solve the quadratic equation developed by Siddhar Acharya, like that. So this is the flow to solve a biquadratic equation, that one depends on cubic equation. Cubic equation depends on quadratic equation. Now my question is, what about fifth or higher degree polynomial or equations, algebraic equation? What is the method to solve a fifth degree equation? What is the method to solve a sixth degree equation? That means find out all the roots for any arbitrary coefficients. So in theory of equation, we have solved lot of problems, lot of theories are there. So lot of techniques are there, but we are handicapped to solve a fifth degree equation after studying the complete theory of equation. So in using, lot of methods are there. We have studied a lot of things, a lot of complicated problems we have solved in UG. But after completion of the course, we are handicapped or we are unable to solve any fifth degree equation like biquadratic equation, quadratic equation, like that. So this is a challenge for the mathematician. And see that a lot of mathematicians are here, the mathematics professor here. We are interestingly escape that problems. So we have no method to solve any fifth degree equation or sixth degree equation. I actually see that after my finishing my PhD, I have joined in a software company at IIT Kharagpur, very small software company. And they given a task. My first task was to solve any arbitrary equation, say 10 degree or even 20 degree equation. That means to find out all the roots of a 20 degree polynomial. So after completion my PhD, when my PhD, I have no idea to solve any arbitrary polynomial, arbitrary 10 or 20 like that. But they asking me to solve, or they have given that particular task to solve a higher degree polynomial. They need roots, all roots. Because to find out the poles, the complex number in complex analysis, we know that poles are there to find out all the poles of a analytical functions. So determine the all. So after my submission, my PhD, have studied how we can find out all the roots during my project. Okay. So you notice that any question of degree greater than 3 or equal to 3 can be extracted as a product of quadratic factors or linear factors. If all the roots of the algebraic equation are real, then we can factorize any polynomial into a linear factors. And if the equation has complex roots, then we can factorize the any arbitrary polynomial into a quadratic polynomial. See that in last in red mark, we have mentioned that a 6-degree polynomial is written as a product of 3 quadratic polynomials. So if it is possible, that is, if it is possible to factorize any arbitrary polynomial into linear or quadratic factor, then we can find out and easily the roots of a quadratic equation or linear equation. There is no problem. But the question is how we can factorize any arbitrary polynomial into quadratic factors. So we never studied this problem, the factorization technique. We have factorized in class 10, 9, 10, and before that, so we learned the factorized technique, lot of factorized technique we have learned, but we have no idea about to factorize the higher degree polynomial, say it's a 10 degree polynomial or 20 degree polynomial like that. But we have a method. We have a method to find out. Let us consider a 5 degree polynomial. This is a 5 degree polynomial. So this polynomial can be factorized into this way, x minus 1 into x square plus something, something lot of that. So this factorization, there is a lot of methods are there. So this factorization is can be done using base 2 method. This is a completely numerical method. This is a completely numerical method. And in that this numerical method, base 2 method can be used to factorize any polynomial. Degree may be say 10, 20, 100 or anything. But if the degree is very high, then it needs a lot of time. But the method gives the guarantee that every polynomial can be factorized into a quadratic factor. Okay, so this is a numerical method. So there is no analytical method to factorize any arbitrary polynomial into a quadratic factor, but a lot of numerical methods are there to factorize into a quadratic factor. So using this method, we can find out all roots of any arbitrary polynomial. But notice that every numerical method gives the errors. But here I have calculated the coefficients of the quadratic factor correct up to 4 decimal places. It is very interesting. Using our high accuracy computer or 16-bit or 32-bit computers, we can calculate higher precision of the decimal number. So this is Pestro method. There is another method, root squaring method, and many others. So roots are these are the roots. So my intention to present this slide or present these problems to know how we can factorize. That means our limitation is in LG standard, our limitation was to find out the roots of up to degree 4. And if the degree is 5-6, there is no method. So we have to find out the other method. So this is the method to find out the roots. So my intention is to present this slide is we have to go for other methods. Other method means other applied methods. It is very essential. We are not stopped to solve up to the 4 degree roots. We have to go for the other roots or other methods. So we, I think 5 minutes time, I can take no 5 minutes. I am presenting this another problem. Matrix multiplication. This is a new method, this is matrix multiplication. This is also the undergraduate problem. So A and B are the given two matrices. You know, this is the matrix representation. Elements are A11, A12, A21, A22. And the product C equal to AB. And the elements are written as C11, C12, C21, and C22. So what are the elements? C11 is this one, C12 is this one. So these are the elements. No, this is the basic matrix multiplication rules we have already studied in class. I think it is now at 11 or 12, matrix basic matrix multiplication. So my question is how many multiplication between elements and addition is required to find out the product of two matrices of order 2x2. Count, see that the total number of multiplications is 8. No, for every element there are 2 multiplication and there are in total 4 additions. So 8 multiplication, 8 additions, 8 multiplications and 4 additions are required to find out the product of 2 2x2 matrices. Okay. Now my question is it possible to find out the product of 2 matrices of order 2x2? Obviously, by multiplying only 7 times. That means using 7 multiplication, can we find the product of 2 matrices of this stretch? And the numbers of angles are, there is no limit. You may use a 10 addition subtraction or say 3 addition subtraction, but you should reduce. You have to reduce only one multiplication. Using 7 multiplication, is it possible to find out the product of 2 matrices? So this is my question. Yeah. Because you see that the multiplication between 2 real numbers, just think about it, the multiplication between 2 real numbers or between 2 integers of 5-digit integer takes more times compared to addition of 2 5-digit numbers. No? If we add 2 5-digit numbers, just we have to add the column by column. No? But for multiplication, we have to multiply by a whole number by a digit, by multiply the whole number by second digit, multiply the whole number by third digit, and after all this multiplication, we have to add them. So multiplication between two numbers take more time compared to addition or subtraction. So reduction of one multiplication is actually gives the first computation. If you reduce the one multiplication, then the computational speed will increase. Basically, this is the aim. So I am presenting you such method, and this method is developed by Dressen. I have mentioned the name earlier. So to multiply 2x2 matrices whose elements are A11, A12, etc., and B11, B12, etc. So to find out the multiplication, we calculate this 7m, M1, M2, M3, M4, M5, M6, and M7. So the formulas are there, and using these 7m's, we calculate C11, C12, C21, C22. So 4 C's are calculated using these formulas. And finally, the product of the matrices of A and B is given by this. C equal to AB equal to C11, C12, C21, and C22. All 4 C's are available here, for last 3 lines. All C's are there, and all C's depends on 7 M's. Okay. Now, the question is, how many total multiplication and addition or subtraction are performed to find out all these 4 C's? Now, calculate count, only 7 multiplications are there. Only 7 multiplications are there, but number of addition and subtractions are increased to 18. Okay, but in our conventional method, we used only 8 multiplication and 4 additions. But here we have reduced one multiplication, and it needs 7 multiplication, but it contains 18. That means 14 addition and subtraction are increased. So this is the alternative method, or the other method to find out the matrix multiplication. Now the question is, a multiplication is reduced, but 14 addition and subtraction are increased. As per computer, addition and subtraction need same amount of time. That means, if the delta amount time is required to add 2 integers, the same amount of time is required to find out the subtraction between 2 integers. Okay, but there is no problem. Addition and subtraction takes the same amount of time, but multiplication and division takes the same amount of time, and this time is much more than the addition and subtraction. So the main question is, if the matrix is of size say n by n, then what amount of time is required to find out the multiplication using this method? So that time is equal to, if the size of the matrices are n by n, then the time of or the total number of multiplication is about n to the power 2.81. But our conventional method, total number of multiplication is n to the power 3. But if we use this method, the total number of multiplication is n to the power 2.81. Notice that n cube is the conventional method, but this method takes n to the power 2.81 multiplication, total number of multiplication. But addition or subtraction is obviously this. So this method is implemented for large matrices, and it is observed that this method is greater than our conventional method. because addition subtraction is highly increased. So there is a big question. If this much addition and subtraction is increased, but only one multiplication is discussed, so is it effective? Or this method is more faster than our conventional method? The answer is yes, this method is faster than our conventional method, even for the large matrices. And order of the matrices are large, even then this method is faster. So the next question is it possible to find out the product of these two matrices using six multiplication? This is the next question. But there is no answer about this problem. There is no answer. I have no idea about this method. So, yeah, there is a method to find out the matrix multiplication, two by two matrix multiplication, using only seven multiplications. So this is the unsolved problem, or let's say this is an open problem. The student may try to find out the multiplication, two by two matrices, using six multiplication. So this is the one example, lot of addition subtraction is there. So these are the two problems I have produced for the students. They can think about the alternative methods to find our conventional method. Okay. So thank you very much for your questions.
Thanks a lot, Professor Pal, for your wonderful speech, which establishes the main underlying thing of our program. And this program is really an enrichment program. We have enriched much more than previously what we have. Multiplication and addition, which one is more convenient for a computer and which can be used for less time in computing. So we shall think, and students also will think about the much progress and how we can easily solve a polynomial of degree higher than 5, 6, or 7. Many, many thanks to Professor Pal for enriching us. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your initiative. I think the next topics will be more benefited for the student and teacher. Okay, thank you very much.
Now I'd like to invite Dr. Sujit Kumar Sardar, Professor of Mathematics, Dadapur University, Department of Mathematics, to deliver his talk. But that, I would like to say a few words about him. Professor Sujit Kumar Sardar presently teaches mathematics in Dadapur University. He has 28 years of experience in teaching in colleges and universities. Before Jadavpur University, he taught at Darjeeling Government College, Hooghly Mohsin College, and University of Barwar. Professor Sardar obtained his BSc Honours in Mathematics degree from Presidency College, Kolkata, MSc in Pure Mathematics from University of Calcutta, and PhD in Pure Mathematics from University of Calcutta under the supervision of Professor T.K. Dutta. He has supervised 15 PhD students and published nearly 100 papers in reputed national and international journals. He has delivered invited talks and visited various universities within and outside India several times. His current research interest is semi-group theory, near algebra, Moivita theory, etc. Besides this, Professor Sardar takes a keen interest in teaching and also on the pedagogic aspects of teaching mathematics. Professor Sardar will deliver his talk on the topic Diagonalizability and canonical forms of linear operators on finite dimensional vector space. I'd like to request Professor Sardar to take over from here. Sir, please.
Excuse me, just give me 2 minutes time to get me ready for presentation, okay?
Okay, thank you, sir. Okay. Thank you.
Sorry.
Okay, sir. No problem.
Thank you for your nice introduction, and I'd like to thank the organizers for inviting me to this webinar. So let me present my screen. Can you see my screen? Hello?
Yes, yes. Very nice.
Hello. Okay, yes. So the screen, there is no problem. So you can see the screen. Yes. So the one thing I like to tell the audience that is like a one-way process. That means I cannot see you, but you can hear me and you can see my screen. So whenever you cannot hear me or you cannot see the screen, please cooperate with me. Just point out that you are not audible. I am not audible to you, etc., etc. Okay.
Okay.
So the title of the topic is Diagonalizability and Canonical Forms of Linear Operators on Finite Dimensional Vector Spaces. So a few words about the title. Actually, this topic I have chosen on request of Rajlokhi, that she told me that students are interested in hearing about these canonical forms. So that's why I have chosen this topic. This is a vast topic. This is a very important and fascinating topic of linear algebra on finite dimensional vector spaces. I also get delight in talking about this topic. So, as always, I like to start with a question. That means, this is my outline. That means in the introduction, I like to present some motivating questions which will lead to the talk. And then I will connect linear transformations on finite dimensional vector spaces and matrices. And then I will talk about diagonalizability, eigenvalues, eigenvectors of linear operators on finite dimensional vector spaces, as well as of square matrices and canonical forms of linear operators on finite dimensional vector spaces, as well as square matrices over a field. So let me put some questions. See the question. Question number one: is it possible to find the determinant and the trace of the 2x2 real matrix or matrices if exist satisfying this equation? That means let me repeat the question. All those 2x2 real matrices A satisfying A square plus A plus I2 means 2x2 identity real matrix. A square plus A plus I2 equal to 0. 0 means the null matrix of order 2. So if such matrices exist, then what will be their determinant and the trace? This is the first question. Now, the same question, if I ask for 3x3 real matrices, then what happens? What will be the answer? Then if we ask the same question for 4x4 real matrices, and again, I want to ask the questions 1, 2, and 3 for complex matrices. That means when the matrix will be 2x2 complex matrix or 3x3 complex matrix or a 4x4 complex matrix. That means this question 4, A, B, C are respectively complex counterparts of 1, 2, and 3. So these are the questions, and one more question is there. Let me have a pause here. Actually, I like to see that I suppose that many of the audience know the answers perhaps, and those who do not know. And another thing, there may be more than one answers. More than one answers means there may be more than one procedures to solve these problems. But the procedures I have in my mind, that depends on the theory I am going to talk about. And another question is, consider the real matrix of order 2, 3, 1, 2, 2, and find a to the power 100, find a to the power 49 plus 4 a to the power 10 plus I2 as usual, the identity matrix of order 2, real matrix of order 2. So these are my questions. Whether the questions are understood or not, that means my scheme is to answer these questions. Because at the end of the discussions, those who do not know the, how to answer these questions, I think they will be able to answer. You see, very strange, the first question is about that whether such matrices exist or not. If it exists, then how to find their determinant and trace, right? So it may happen that by trial and error method, you can find one matrix of order 2 satisfying this equation, and you can find its determinant and trace. But the question is whether there exist other matrices or not with this property. So what will be their determinant and trace? And the same question for these matrices of other orders and also for complex matrices. So see how to approach the questions. So for question number 1 to 4, see, let us consider the following facts and what are the consequences of those facts, what tasks we have to complete. Fact one is that we know that two similar matrices have the same determinant. Two similar matrices have the same trace. These are very elementary facts. And if A satisfies the given condition, that means A square plus A plus I2 equal to 0, then any matrix similar to A also satisfies the given condition. It is very easy to check that any similar matrix, a matrix similar with A, will also satisfy that condition. Then the question is that if we can find the similarity classes, so I will explain it, what I mean by the similarity classes. Similarity classes in M to R, right, for question number 1, and in M to C for question number 4A, I am just dealing with 2 by 2 matrices now. So similarity classes and for other cases also, such that the members of those similarity classes satisfy the given condition. That means, if you take this set M to R, and if you can find the similarity classes, I will explain it in a short while. Let me explain that, what I mean by similarity classes. Okay, and coming to question number 4 later, 5. Let me explain question number 5. For question number 5, what we have to consider, the facts are that the power of a diagonal matrix is very easy to find, right? Because if the diagonal matrix means all off diagonal elements are 0, and if you raise to some power to a diagonal matrix, then this that matrix, resulting matrix, will be just the matrix obtained from the given matrix just raising to the same power the elements on the diagonal, principal diagonal. And you see the diagonals are 2, 3, 4, 5 like this, then if you raise to some power the matrix, then this 2, 3, 4, 5, they will be raised to the same power and the resulting matrix will be there, diagonal matrix. If the matrix is not diagonal but similar to a diagonal matrix, that means if similar to a diagonal matrix, suppose A is similar to a diagonal matrix, then A can be written as P inverse DP, where D is a diagonal matrix, then to find the power of A to the power N, then this P inverse DP whole to the power N will be P inverse D to the power N. P is very easy to check, and this D to the power N is easy to calculate, and in that case, just this multiplication P inverse D to the power N P is a very small multiplication, then it will be very easy to find the power of A. even if it is a bigger matrix or whatever be the matrix, if it is diagonalizable, if it is not a diagonal matrix. So the main thing is that whether it is question number 1 to 4 or question number 5, what is the key concept? That means the concept we are using here, we have to use here. That is the concept of similarity of matrices. Am I clear? So far, the things are clear or not? That means why the similarity of matrices, this notion is key here. That is the key to answer the questions I have raised, right? Now, let me define what you mean by similar matrices. These are known, but for the sake of completeness, let me repeat it. Suppose A and B are two square matrices of same order, and A is said to be similar to B over A if there exists an invertible matrix P such that B equal to P inverse AP. Now, relation of being similar over MNF stands for the set of all N by N matrices over A. This is an equivalence relation. So, similarity classes of MNF are the equivalence classes under the relation of being similar. So, one thing I should mention here that this equivalence, the notion of equivalence relation is a very important relation in algebra. And if acts in silence, like the Archimedean property acts in real analysis, right? So, here again, this notion of equivalence relation is coming, you see. The relation of being similar is an equivalence relation. What is the main property of an equivalence relation? It partitions the set. And the partitions are equivalence classes, mutually disjoint equivalence classes. So each class under this relation of similarity are called, each class is called a similarity class. So our problem is to, you see, if we, in order to solve the problems, we have to find the similarity classes. That means, if we know that how many classes are there whose elements are satisfying the given condition, then from each class you take one element, because you know that, say again, this a given fact, just you look at this, what I was going to say, that is written here also. Every matrix A will belong to one and only one equivalence class. This is the property of equivalence class. That means if you take an equivalence relation on a set, and if you then that will partition the set, then every element of the set will belong to one and only one equivalence class, and no element can escape the equivalence class. Right? This is very important. And two equivalence classes are either identical or they are disjoint. So our task here is to find all the similarity classes in the given condition. And for question number 1, to be specific, we have to consider M2R, and there the relation of being similar, what will be the classes we have to identify. That is, to identify one class, we have to identify one representative of the class only. Because if we know one representative, we know all other elements. And if we know one representative and its determinant and trace, then that will give the determinant trace of every element of that class. So equivalence classes are highly democratic. But we are interested in that representative, which is canonical. It's canonical. So most of the time, students do not understand that what is meant by canonical. Canonical means natural. Here it is meaning as simple as possible. Right? I have written here, as if we are left-minded Bengalis, that means we like to see our representatives as simple as possible, right? What do you mean by a simple matrix? That means, so what do you mean here by simplicity of a matrix? That I am going to explain. So, I take an example here. When we talk about congruence modulo n, there the canonical representatives are 0 bar, 1 bar, 2 bar, etc., n minus 1 bar. Now, matrices having 0 as an entry in as many places as possible can be considered to be simple. This is the simple thing. That means we are very much interested in the representative, those representatives which have many zeros. Because in that case, it is very easy to handle with computation. So the most nice candidate for canonical representative is a diagonal matrix. Because diagonal matrix is such a representative That means such a matrix where most of the zeros occur. That means except the diagonal elements, that means all off-diagonal elements are zero, right? And the diagonal elements may be zero or maybe non-zero, but all off-diagonal elements are zero. So diagonal matrices are the matrices having most zeros as entries. So these are very nice matrices, very simple matrices. The next best candidates are block diagonal matrices, where the blocks are either, our blocks are either elementary Jordan matrices, I'm going to explain what you mean by that, and companion matrices. These also I'm going to explain. That means block diagonal matrices means a square matrix where the blocks, except the blocks, all other places are filled with zeros, right? And there the blocks are either elementary Jordan matrices or companion matrices. So we are interested in those representatives for the similarity classes. The either the representative is a diagonal matrix or a block diagonal matrix where the blocks are elementary Jordan matrices or companion matrices, right? So these three, in these three representatives we are interested. Now let me define what you mean by elementary Jordan matrices. Let me explain. Corresponding to a scalar lambda, the elementary Jordan matrices respectively of order one Jordan matrix will look like this, and of order two, it will look like this. That means a triangular matrix, lambda on the principal diagonal and the ones on the super diagonal or on the sub diagonal. And for 3x3 order elementary Jordan matrix corresponding to lambda, lambda is on the principal diagonal and ones are on the super diagonal or on the sub diagonal. In this way, you can define elementary Jordan matrices of other orders. And a k by k matrix of this form, you see, look at this matrix here, this except the last column and the sub diagonal, all other elements are zero. Okay. You see this last column, except the sub-diagonal, all other elements are zero, and the sub-diagonal, all elements are one. Either these or except the last row and the super-diagonal, all other elements are zero, and the super-diagonal elements all are one. Then these types of matrices, either these or these, they are called companion matrices, companion matrix of the monic polynomial. You see this monic polynomial, how it is, how we are getting this from this matrix. So look at this minus A0, minus A1, etc., minus AK, minus 1, minus A0, that means A0 is the constant term, A1 is the coefficient of that, coefficient of X, A2 is the coefficient of x square in this way, AK minus 1 is the coefficient of x to the power k minus 1. And this is a kth degree monic polynomial with these coefficients. And then if you start from the constant terms with sign changed and write either in the column or in the row, last column or in the last row, and accordingly on the subdiagonal or on the superdiagonal, all entries 1, then the matrix we get, that is called the companion matrix of this polynomial. So if the degree of the polynomial is k, then this order of this matrix will be k. So we are interested in those representatives, either the representative is a diagonal matrix or a block diagonal matrix consisting of the blocks of these types, that means elementary Jordan matrices, or blocks of these types. Right? So we are interested in these three types of representatives for the similarity classes. So now I think that canonical means natural, sometimes it means natural, sometimes it means simple as possible, like this. Now, here one fact I should mention that when we say that companion matrix of this polynomial, sometimes a question is given like this. So, given this monic polynomial, find a matrix whose characteristic polynomial as well as minimal polynomial is this given polynomial. Then the companion matrix will be the answer. But I have not explained what you mean by minimal polynomial of a matrix. A characteristic polynomial, I suppose that it is known to everybody. Minimal polynomial is known to almost all the audience, maybe many audience, some audience there who do not know what is minimal polynomial of a matrix. Okay, I will explain it in course of the discussion. So, in this introductory part, I think I am clear. That means I am mainly interested that I have given some questions, some problems, how to answer those problems. That means ultimately, we have to find similarity classes. Similarity classes to determine similarity classes means to determine one representative, and that representative will be canonical or as simple as possible. The simplicity we have defined as that either it is a diagonal matrix or it is a block diagonal matrix with elementary Jordan matrices on the blocks or companion matrices on the blocks. Right? Now the question is how to find a canonical representative, right? So far I am discussing about matrices. I have not yet talked about linear operators on a finite dimensional vector space. Now how to find canonical representative? Given a matrix A, now what is the procedure to find canonical representatives? The desired representatives, as I mentioned. So why, let us analyze a bit. By definition of the similarity class of A means this P inverse AP, just a P varies over this N by N invertible matrices over A. You consider one P, you will get P inverse AP, this is similar to A, that means the similarity class of A is this set. Now, how to determine this set, or at least one representative of this similarity class? How to find it? And another thing, when a matrix is given specifically, here you see in the problem, the matrix is not given specifically. Rather, it is given by some property, right? But there are various, there may be more than one matrices satisfying the same property. Then how to find those, in that case, how to find the similarity classes, right? That is a problem. Now, what is the role of linear transformation in this problem? Let's see. Now, to understand a matrix of order m by n over field A, what we have to do? We have to make it act. Because if you want to know somebody or some entity, then unless it does not act, then you cannot understand about that entity. So, how can it act? How can a matrix act? Or where can it act? So, matrix can be added, matrix can be multiplied. These are also actions by matrices. Actually, in a sense, that means they're acting. But observe that they have certain other things to do. If you take, say, M by N matrix, and then that will give rise to a correspondence of functions from Fn to Fn. Our matrix is of order m by n, right, over the field A, and then we can define a function from Fn to Fm in this way, in a very canonical way, that the x goes to Ax. Here x means, here the notational thing, here actually this Fn, to be precise, this is n by 1, that means n by set of all n by 1 matrices. From the context, there will be no confusion. Sometimes these are called, these to be taken as 1 by n matrices. Sometimes these are to be taken as n by 1 matrices. Here they are one n by 1 matrix. So, corresponding to A, we are getting a function from Fn to Fm, x goes to Ax. That means left multiplication by x. And the matrix algebra says that this LA, this function, is a linear transformation from the vector space Fn to Fm. Now, there is a bit digression. You see, digression means this is relevant to mention here what I'm going to say. Maybe it may appear to be a bit digression from the main discussion. you see, corresponding to a matrix, we are getting a linear transformation, right? Now the question is whether this matrix gives rise to a linear transformation from Fn to Fm only, or from an n-dimensional vector space to another m-dimensional vector space over the same field A. Yes, there also this A can also define a linear transformation from G to W, where D is an n-dimensional vector space over F and W is an m-dimensional vector space over F. How? You see, so diagrammatically you can see it. If you start with a, then in this case, actually what happens, this is very canonical. You see, when we take A and when you define LA from Fn to Fm, X goes to Ax. So what is the advantage of dealing with the vector spaces of type Fn over the finite dimensional vector spaces V of dimension n over A? Advantage is, when we take an element of Fn, we write an n-tuple. That means that n-tuple denotes the coordinates of that vector with respect to standard ordered basis. That means whenever we take the vector spaces of type Fn, then a vector of that vector space means an n-tuple, the coordinates are the coordinates of the vector with respect to the standard ordered basis. But for an arbitrary vector space of dimension n, we have to choose a basis. So let us, now the point is how to get a function from V to W using the matrix A of order m by n. You see this diagram, if you start with this V, small v, take from capital V, we have fixed a basis V1 for V and V2 for W. Now small v goes to its coordinates, this V square bracket V, the suffix V1 means these are the coordinates of V, that means V can be written as a unique linear combination of V1, V2, etc., Vn of these basis elements. Those scalars written in a column, this is denoted by this. This is an element of Fn. And then you apply here LA. So LA will take this to this. And you call it, if you call it Y, that means Y1, etc., Ym. Then you just take a linear combination of these basis V2 of W, W1, etc., Wm by Y1, etc., Ym, this Y1, W1, etc., Ym, Wm, you are getting a vector here in capital W, you denote it by small w. Starting with small v from capital V, we are getting a small w from capital W. That means we have been able to establish a correspondence from V to W, but with the help of these chosen bases, V1 and V2. And in this way, A defines a linear, this correspondence is a linear transformation very easy to prove from V to W, right? And for the converse part, if you see, suppose you have V and W, two finite dimensional vector spaces over the same field, then you know if you choose ordered basis here for the domain space and the codomain space, you can define the matrix representation of the linear transformation. If a linear transformation is given, that means the matrix representation, that means the converse. Then starting with a matrix, you can get a linear transformation, and for a linear transformation, there is a matrix representation. So, okay. Okay, let me come back to the main discussion. Now, our interest is to find the similarity classes for a given matrix, for square matrix. We have confined ourselves to the discussion of square matrices. Okay, that was our initial problem. So how to find the similarity classes? So the similarity classes, these as already mentioned there. Now you see, in the similarity classes, the members are similar, that means P inverse AP is similar to A. What other relations do P inverse AP and A have, other than being similar? What is P? What is such a P? There is P an invertible matrix, right? This is P an invertible matrix. Anything else can you say about P? You see, look at this. What are the importance of invertible matrices you see? This P inverse AP and A, they are similar, but they have, other than being similar, they have this relationship. That means they are the matrices of the same linear operator with respect to two different ordered bases. Am I clear what I told? That means I asked you that other than being similar by definition, A and P inverse appear similar, but they have this relationship. They are the matrices of the same linear operator. Which linear operator I am going to show you with respect to different order bases. So look at this. If you take LA, that is corresponding to a matrix A, we know what you mean by LA, that means a linear transformation just by left multiplication by A. So this LA, if you take the ordered basis here, standard ordered basis of FN and FM, here again for the general case I told you perhaps, but there is a mistake perhaps, this M will be N, okay, this M will be N, there's a typo, right? So if we take here the standard ordered basis of FN, then the matrix of LA will be A, right? Now, P inverse AP, then what is P inverse AP? Then P inverse AP will be the matrix of LA also with respect to different ordered basis. What is that basis? So that basis is a basis which changes from the standard ordered basis to that basis. Now, let me explain what you mean by transition matrix or change of basis. Suppose you have a basis B1, then you, if you take another basis B2, for such a change of basis, there corresponds a matrix known as a transition matrix or the change of basis matrix. How it is related, I am showing you. But the thing is that if we consider this LA, this linear transformation, then this A and P inverse AP will be matrices of LA with respect to different ordered basis. Right? That is the point I told you. Other than being similar, they have this relationship. Now, what do you mean by transition matrix you see here? Suppose B is V1, etc. Vn, B prime is V1 prime, etc. Vn prime. Now, if you express these elements of B prime as a unique linear combination of the elements of B, then these coefficients, if you construct a matrix with these coefficients as the columns, then the matrix you will get, that is called the change of basis matrix or transition matrix from B to B prime, right? Now, then to find similarity classes actually means starting from A, if we want to find P inverse AP, that means P corresponds to a change of basis from the standard here for FN, from standard ordered basis to some other basis. What is that basis? Basis is actually if you take look at the definition of transition matrix, this P is a transition matrix, right? That means P corresponds to this change of basis. Now what is that basis? Basis will be, if you take the columns of P and if you take the linear combination of the standard ordered basis, then you will get a set of N elements. That means with columns as the coordinates and with respect to the standard ordered basis, and that basis is the change of basis, new basis, with respect to which the matrix of LA will be P inverse AP. That means our task reduces to find a suitable basis. That means suitable basis means, I don't know whether I have been able to make you clear that what you mean by this P. P is nothing but a matrix, a transition matrix, right? Now, how to find the transition matrix? That means you have to find a suitable basis, basis of what? A basis of FN, so that matrix of LA becomes P inverse AP. And if it happens that P inverse AP is of our desired type, that means either it is a diagonal matrix or matrix consisting of the elementary Jordan matrices as blocks or as the companion matrices as the blocks, right? So how to find that suitable basis? That means to find the similarity classes of A of the desired type or whatever type, actually here the desired type, that means we have to find a suitable basis, basis of FN, right? So, I want to ask that up to what I've said is clear to you or not. Do we have any questions to this? This is very important because you see what we are going to do to find the similarity classes. That means to find the similarity classes of a given matrix is to find a suitable basis. That point is clear or not? Hello? I expect some response from the audience.
Sir.
Is it clear?
Yes.
If it is not, I can repeat it. That means our problem is to find similarity classes of some suitable type, canonical type, right? My point is that that problem reduces to find a suitable basis. If the matrix is of order n over the field F, that means we have to find a suitable basis of the vector space Fn, right? And that basis will give us the matrix P such that P inverse AP will be the desired type of matrix, desired type of representative of our similarity classes, right? That means this finding this P, suitable P, is nothing but to find a suitable basis. That is the point. That is clear or not? Just look at this. Okay. If it is not clear, then with this diagram, let me clear this. What I want to say here, you see, if you start with a matrix A of order n, then this defines a linear transformation from Fn to Fn, right? Now, with respect to SOB means a standard ordered basis. If you take the standard ordered basis, then the matrix of LA will be A, right? Now, you keep on changing basis, standard order basis to some other basis, say B1, the matrix is say A1, right? If you call this matrix of, this notation is for the matrix of LA with respect to the basis B1, if you denote it by A1, A1 is P1 inverse AP1. What is P1? P1 is the transition matrix from the standard order, for the change of basis from standard order basis to B1, right? Tn means transition matrix. Then A1 is related with A by this P1 inverse AP1. If you change the basis from B1 to B2, then the transition matrix is P2, then the matrix of LA will be P2 inverse A1 P2. Right? In this way, actually, we're changing from standard order basis to this basis, then this basis, then in this way, whether we can get a suitable basis B, right? I'm talking about diagonalizability for the time being. Suppose, is it possible to find a suitable basis B such that the matrix of LA is a diagonal matrix B, right? Now, if you forget about these middle steps, just suppose if you start from the standard order basis and whether it is possible to find a basis B such that this happens, then we can say, then see a change from standard order basis to the basis B. If the transition matrix is P, then P inverse AP is this diagonal matrix. Look at this. If you forget about this middle step, suppose starting with the standard order basis, is it possible to find a basis B such that the matrix of LA is a diagonal matrix? So that means A and B are similar, and this transition matrix is P. That means this P corresponds to change of this matrix B. Then B, how is B obtained? If you express the elements of B as a linear combination of the standard order basis and take the coordinates and put it into the columns, then that matrix will be the matrix P. That means this suitable matrix P is nothing but the transition matrix from this change of basis from SOB to B. That means to find a suitable P is nothing but to find a suitable basis. That I was trying to tell you. I think now it is clear to you. Okay?
Yes, sir. We have got response from the audience present in YouTube. They are saying that so far it is clear.
Okay. Thank you. Okay. So my point is, that means to find the similarity classes, we have to find a suitable invertible matrix that reduces to find a suitable basis. That is very important. Okay. Now, the most nice canonical representative is diagonal matrix. So when it happens, let us analyze this. Now, we can concentrate our discussion on finite dimension, on linear operators on finite dimensional vector spaces, not on matrices. What is the advantage? Advantage is, you see, we can interchange theory to that theory, but the advantage of dealing with linear operators, though we are confined to finite dimensional vector spaces, but linear operators can be defined on any vector space, not necessarily of finite dimension, but matrix has that limitations. That matrix, so far you consider the matrix as a linear operator, that means you have to confine yourself on finite dimensional vector spaces only. That's why we are dealing with linear operators instead of matrices. This is one reason, right? So suppose T is a linear operator on a finite dimensional vector space V, and if there exists an ordered basis V, such that matrix is this diagonal matrix, right? Then we say that the operator T is diagonalizable, right? So what happens when an operator is diagonalizable? Look at this. And when we define the diagonality of a matrix, perhaps the most commonly used square matrix A is said to be diagonalizable if there exists an invertible matrix P such that P inverse AP is a diagonal matrix. But I will say that it is equivalent to saying that if LA is diagonalizable as an operator, that diagram, if you recall that diagram, then it says that only, right? The A is diagonalizable if LA is diagonalizable. Okay. Now, for a diagonalizable linear operator, that means you have to have a basis P consisting of V1, etc., Vn, such that the matrix of T with respect to V, it is a diagonal matrix. Then what happens by the definition of matrix representation, TV1 is lambda 1, V1, TV2 is lambda 2, V2, etc., TVn is lambda n, Vn. That means the basis elements, they have a very nice property with respect to T. That means T is mapping each basis element to its scalar multiple, right? If you confine yourself to a vector space R2, then it simply means, that means this mapping V1 to a parallel vector to V1, right? So if V has a basis such that matrix of T is a diagonal matrix, then this basis elements and these scalars on the principal diagonal, they are connected by these relations. TV1 is lambda 1, V1, TV2 is lambda 2, V2, etc., TVn is lambda n, Vn, right? This gives a nice motivation for introducing this concept of eigenvalues and eigenvectors of a linear operator on a finite dimensional vector space or for any vector space, not necessarily a finite dimension. So let me define this formally. Suppose V is a vector space, not necessarily finite dimensional, over a field A, and T be a linear operator. So if there exists lambda belonging to the underlying field and a non-zero vector V such that T V equal to lambda V, then lambda is called an eigenvalue of T and V is called an eigenvector of T associated with lambda. See, the definition, look at the definition. That means what you have to have? You have to have a lambda in the underlying field and a non-zero vector V so that this equation is satisfied, T V equal to lambda V. Then lambda is called an eigenvalue of T, V is called an eigenvector of T associated with lambda. Now, if V satisfies this condition, then any mu V also satisfies this equation where mu is non-zero scalar, right? That means if V is an eigenvector associated with lambda, then there are so many eigenvectors depending on the field. Right? Any non-zero scalar multiple of D is also an eigenvector. Say, one thing I should mention, that in some books, zero is also considered to be an eigenvector, but here I have not considered this.
Hello, sir.
Hello?
Sir, your voice is not clear.
Aurobindo, hello?
Yes, sir.
Voice is not clear, but I am not moving so much. Hello, is there any problem, Rajalokki? Hello, am I audible?
Sir, you are audible most of the time, but sometimes it gets actually
problematic.
Sometimes it gets problematic, but most of the time you are being audible.
Okay. I'm trying. So that the problem does not occur. Okay.
Sir,
I think it is coming.
I have got from YouTube. Can I pose here, sir?
Hello?
Sir, one question I have got from YouTube. Hello? Sir, one question I got from YouTube. The question is, Molloy Fine asked that, what is the role of a non-singular matrix P instead of singular matrix?
Where?
I think he's talking about singular AP thing. What is a role of non-singular matrix P instead of singular matrix?
Oh, instead of singular matrix. Yes. Because you see, any matrix induces or displays a linear transformation or linear operator, if it is a square matrix. So you are talking about a square matrix. So any square matrix displays a linear operator. But the problem we are discussing is, that is the problem of finding singularity classes. Then we have to deal with the invertible or non-singular matrices only. Okay? There is no problem in defining a linear operator with a singular matrix. But our problem is to deal with the similarity classes. That's why you are dealing with non-singular matrices. Are you satisfied? Hello?
I think, sir, he has got his answer, sir.
Okay. There is no problem of defining, or repeating, there is no problem of defining a linear operator with a singular matrix, but the problem we are dealing with, that requires non-singular matrices. Or the change of basis corresponds to non-singular matrices only. So far, what I have told in a word, in a sentence, I can say that to find the similarity classes is equivalent to find a suitable basis. Right, of the vector space FN. Anyway, so now I'm coming back to this. So then the definition of eigenvalue and eigenvector, that is clear. Right? Okay. Then what happens, it is an easy observation. That means if you have a basis with respect to which the linear operator, the matrix of the linear operator is a diagonal matrix, then the basis consists of eigenvectors. Because this eigenvalue and eigenvector are related by this TV equal to lambda V. So there, what you have seen there, that TV1 equal to lambda 1 v1, tv2 equal to lambda 2 v2, tvn equal to lambda n vn, then v1, v2, vn, these are all eigenvectors, and lambda 1, etc., these are all eigenvalues, right? So, an operator on a finite dimensional vector space is diagonalizable, is equivalent to saying that the vector space has a basis consisting of eigenvectors. Now, some important related notions regarding your this eigenvalues, eigenvectors, etc. If you start with an eigenvalue lambda, if you consider all V satisfying TV equal to lambda V, that means here I have included the null vector also, because the null vector satisfies this equation also. So except the null vector, all are eigenvectors. That means all eigenvectors associated with lambda, including the null vector, this is denoted by E lambda. This is called the eigenspace of T. I'm sorry, I made a mistake here. Eigenspace of not V, but it is eigenspace of T associated with lambda. And this is nothing but kernel of T minus lambda I, where I is the identity operator on V. Okay, and dimension of E lambda, that means the nullity of T minus lambda I, this is called the geometric multiplicity of lambda. Right? And one important fact that dimension, if dimension D is finite, one thing, just let me repeat that when we have defined eigenvalue, eigenvector for an operator on a vector space, the vector space need not be finite dimensional, right? That you keep in mind. But the problem is, whenever you want to find the eigenvalues of a linear operator, if the dimension D is finite, then the things become very easy. See here, the eigenvalues of T are precisely the roots lying in F of the monic polynomial determinant of xi v minus t. Xi v means, iv means the identity operator on V, and t means the given operator, and the determinant of an operator, this is a meaningful concept because determinant of any matrix of the operator can be defined to be the determinant of the operator, because any two matrices are similar, similar matrices have the same determinant. So determinant of an operator on a finite dimensional vector space is meaningful. So one can easily check that from this definition, TV equal to lambda V, one can deduce that lambda satisfies this polynomial determinant xi V minus T. So the roots of this polynomial lying in the underlying field are precisely the eigenvalues. T is diagonalizable even only V as a basis consisting of eigenvectors of T. And the eigenvalues and eigenvectors of a square matrix can be defined to be the eigenvalues and eigenvectors of the linear operator LA. Now, you can say that you already know eigenvalues and eigenvectors of a matrix, but this new definition and that definition, they are equivalent. This is your this is an easy exercise to solve. Okay. Now the theory about linear operators on finite dimensional vector spaces and that of square matrices, they are interchangeable, right? That means if you study the theory for one, then you can translate it for the other. You have to the method of translation. That means if you study it for operator T, then for the matrix, if you want to translate, you translate via LA. So for example, when you say that A is diagonalizable, as I defined that if and only if LA is diagonalizable, that means LA is diagonalizable means if you go back to that diagram, that means you have to find a suitable basis with respect to which the matrix of LA is a diagonal matrix, and this basis, there corresponds a change of basis matrix. That means simply if you start with the standard ordered basis of Fn, and if you consider this basis with respect to which the matrix of LA is a diagonal matrix, then if you put these elements on the columns, the matrix you will obtain, that will give you, that means P inverse AP and the matrix of LA with respect to this basis, they are the same. Okay, what I told you, that this P inverse AP is nothing but the matrix of LA with respect to this basis P, where B and the standard ordered basis are connected by this matrix P, that means the transition matrix. Okay, now what are the necessary and sufficient conditions for diagonalizability of linear operators on finite dimensional vector spaces? There are many, but you see, let me begin with some results, elementary results in this direction. Eigenvectors corresponding to distinct eigenvalues are linearly independent, right? Eigenspaces corresponding to distinct eigenvalues are independent. This term may be new to some audience. Some subspaces are independent means what? Means they form direct sum. Again, what is the meaning of that? Meaning is this, that means if you take their sum, then that will be a direct sum. That means if you take one element from each subspace and if you add them, if that equate to zero, then they have to be individually zero. This is another equivalent condition. So eigenspaces corresponding to distinct eigenvalues are independent, or they form a direct sum. This is another variant of this result one. And result one gives a sufficient condition for diagonalizability, because if the eigenvectors corresponding to distinct eigenvalues are linearly independent, if all the eigenvalues are distinct, then the operator will be diagonalizable, right? Because corresponding to every there will be n distinct eigenvalues if the dimension is n, and you will get n linearly independent eigenvectors, and that will form a basis, and that basis consists of eigenvectors, so T will be diagonalizable. So this is a sufficient condition. That means all eigenvalues are distinct. Result 2, that means the eigenspaces form a direct sum that gives this result. That means if the direct sum becomes the whole space, then this, from this definition of direct sum, if you string together the bases of E lambda 1, etc., that means the eigenspaces, that will give you the whole basis, that means the basis of B, and that will consist of eigenvectors of the operator T. So in that case, T will be diagonalizable. This is an if and only condition, right? So another variance, some other variants are these. Let me see if the characteristic polynomial is these, and the WIs are the null spaces. That means Xi minus lambda 1T, right? So these null spaces, if WI is the null spaces, then of lambda, this corresponds. Is it clear to everybody? What are WIs? Null space of T minus lambda I? I, right? So if that means the geometric multiplicities and the algebraic multiplicities are the same, this is a very well-known result, then T is diagonalizable, if and only if. Or another version is the dimension W1, etc., dimension WK is dimension B. All are the same, different variants, right? But these set of necessary and sufficient conditions for diagonalizability is not effective for solving problems. So we have to find out some powerful method, that means the effective method in solving problems. And that powerful result so far as this diagonalizability problem is concerned, this notion of minimal polynomial plays an important role. You see, what is minimal polynomial? Let me explain. Annihilating polynomial, annihilate means to kill. That means if you take a polynomial fx, and such that ft equal to 0, that means the null operator, then fx is said to be an annihilating polynomial of t. And if you consider a set of all annihilating polynomials for the operator t, that will be an ideal of this PID, fx. Okay. And the unique monic generator of this ideal has many generators, but it has one and only one monic generator. And then that monic generator is called the minimal polynomial of the operator T. But the problem is, those who are not familiar with this ideal, etc., and this generator, etc., they have a problem to understand this minimal polynomial. That's why there is another simple version of minimal polynomial. That is, the minimal polynomial is a unique monic polynomial of least degree annihilating T. That means, you consider all monic polynomials which are annihilating T, among them there will be one and only one with least degree. That is also the minimal polynomial, right? But this definition has as a disadvantage. That is, it does not say, that means this definition does not say that the minimal polynomial divides at once, does not at once say that minimal polynomial divides any annihilating polynomial. But this definition says this. But here, from this definition, if you have to deduce this, then you have to apply the division algorithm for polynomials, right? But the fact is that the minimal polynomial divides any annihilating polynomial. This is a remarkable result, because if you know one annihilating polynomial, you can guess about the minimal polynomials, because minimal polynomial divides any annihilating polynomial. So knowing one annihilating polynomial means you know all its factors, and one of the factors will be the minimal polynomial, right? That means if you know one annihilating polynomial, you know the possibilities of minimal polynomials, right? So now you just recall this question 1 to question 4. If the matrix satisfies A square plus A plus I equal to 0, that means x square plus x plus 1 is an annihilating polynomial of the matrix A, right? Now again, I want to recall that we are dealing with operators on finite dimensional vector spaces, but I am here illustrating that theory for this with this matrix. As I told you, that we can interchange, that means we can translate the theory for linear operators for matrices, square matrices. So the theory we have discussed for linear operators, those are equally applicable for square matrices. So this, if a matrix satisfies this equation, means x square plus x plus 1 is an annihilating polynomial of this matrix, right? So the if this polynomial has any factor, then the possible factors are the possible minimal polynomials. So what? The question is, if you know the minimal polynomials, then what is the advantage? What you are gaining knowing the minimal polynomial? You see, there is a remarkable result, you see.
Sir, I'm interrupting you for once. There is a question regarding polynomials, so I'm communicating this to you.
Minimal polynomial?
Yeah, there is a question regarding minimal polynomial.
Okay, I'm very happy to have the questions. Okay.
Pine asks that, is minimal polynomial of a matrix unique? If not, then there is any method to find unique monic polynomial? I'm repeating this question again. Minimal polynomial of a matrix, is minimal polynomial of a matrix unique? If not, then there is any method to find unique monic polynomial?
Okay, let me go back to the definition. Perhaps you did not follow the definition. See, minimal polynomial of a matrix or an operator is defined to be the unique monic generator of this ideal, because by this definition, minimal polynomial is unique, right? But the problem is you are getting confused with one thing, that is, suppose that in our case, so matrix satisfying some property, that means you do not know the matrix explicitly. In that case, you may not be able to find the exact minimal polynomial. Rather, you can find the possible minimal polynomials. And that gives you the impression a minimal polynomial perhaps is not unique. It's not that. For a given particular matrix or an operator, the unique monic polynomial, minimal polynomial is unique by definition. But the problem is, the given conditions may not help you to find that unique polynomial or the minimal polynomial. That's a different issue, right? You do not have sufficient information about the matrix to find the minimal polynomial. What you can find with the help of the hypothesis or given conditions, perhaps the possible minimal polynomials, as is our in our case, in when I will discuss some of the specific problems I have raised at the beginning, right? There you will see in some cases we are able to find the minimal polynomial precisely, and some cases we are not able to do that, we are getting some possible minimal polynomials. That doesn't mean that the minimal polynomial of an operator or a matrix is not unique, right? It is unique by definition.
Okay, sir, I think he has got his answer. So please continue.
Okay. Now, what I was telling, what is the importance of this minimal polynomial, notion of minimal polynomials as far as this problem of diagonalizability is concerned, or this problem of canonical forms, etc., is concerned, right? This is one important result, is very remarkable result. T is diagonalizable if and only if, I think I have missed another result, just it is this one. The characteristic polynomial and the minimal polynomial have the same roots except the multiplicities. This is a very important result. You see, this gives you some idea about the importance of minimal polynomial. If you know the minimal polynomial, if you know an annihilating polynomial, you know the possible minimal polynomials, then you can have the idea about the possible eigenvalues because of this result without counting multiplicity. That means the characteristic polynomial, if the roots of the characteristic polynomials are precisely the eigenvalues, and if the characteristic polynomial and the minimal polynomial have the same roots, except the multiplicities, then if you know the minimal polynomial, you know the eigenvalues, right? But not their multiplicities. Am I clear? Suppose if you consider x minus 2 whole square into x minus 3, the roots are 2 and 3. If I say the roots are 3, 2 and 3, not counting multiplicities, then I am correct. But if I have to say the roots are, what are the roots? Roots are 2, 2, 3, right? So knowing the minimal polynomial means you know that all the eigenvalues without their multiplicities in view of this result. And this result is not so difficult to prove. Another result you see, T is diagonalizable if and only if its minimal polynomial is a product of distinct linear factors. Right? Distinct linear factors means it will be of the form x minus 2 into x minus 3 into x plus 5 like this. Right? Not like x minus 2 into x minus 2 into x minus 3. And so whatever be this T is diagonalizable if and only if the product of distinct linear factors, then one thing is necessary for this to happen, that is the characteristic polynomial or the minimal polynomial should split into linear factors, right? Over the underlying field. But you see, depending on the field, if the field is not algebraically closed, it may not happen always. That the polynomial may not split into linear factors. In that case, if the T is so well behaved in that sense, that means its characteristic polynomial or the minimal polynomial splits into linear factors, then it may happen without the field being algebraically closed. Right? But is expecting the characteristic polynomial splitting into linear factors irrespective of the underlying field, is it quite justified? Is it quite rational? I call it to be a bit irrational. Okay? So we are interested in rational canonical forms. Right? So one can say this is a motivation for calling this rational canonical form. But this is not exactly the situation, okay? So one can say it. That means, whatever be the underlying field, if it happens, the minimal polynomial splits into linear factors, right? Then it is okay, very nice. But if it does not, then what happens? Can't we get any canonical form? Yes, the canonical form we will be able to obtain in that case, that is known as rational canonical form. Rational here means it is quite rational, then it does not depend on the underlying field. Okay. Now, what do you mean by rational canonical form? Now, you see, so far what I have told, almost everything I have explained, but now, so I have to do this shortcut. That means I think it is not the proper platform or say proper possible to make clear everything about these canonical forms. That means including the details of this. Here I am just mentioning the result only. Suppose V is a finite dimensional vector space, or suppose if Mx is the minimum, then there exist monic polynomials F1x, F2x, etc., Fkx, not necessarily all distinct, with the property that F1x divides F2x, divides F3x, etc., each one divides the next one in this way, divides Fkx, Fkx is the minimal polynomial Mx. And these polynomials are unique with this property for a given operator T. Unique with the property means with this property of division. That is, one is dividing the other, next one. Right? So this is a remarkable result you see. For every finite dimensional vector space and for every operator on that, we will be able to find such polynomials with this property. And this is unique in the sense, if someone gets another set of polynomials with this property, suppose f1, f2, etc., f10, then with this property, then k and 10. And in this case, if you take the product of these polynomials, then this product will be the characteristic polynomial of t. And this f1x, f2x, etc., fkx, they are called the invariant factors of t. Right? Am I clear here? The result I have stated. If you are given a finite dimensional vector space and a linear operator on that, then there exists monic polynomials with this property. These are called invariant factors of the operator t. Now, if C1, C2, etc., Ck are the companion matrices respectively of these polynomials, F1x, etc., Fkx, and if you put them on the blocks, then this block diagonal matrix, this is called the rational canonical form of the operator T. Is it clear? Hello? Hello? Hello?
Yes, sir. You are audible, sir.
Okay. Is it clear what I told? Just remember this. But here, I have little scope to explain more than this. Right?
Okay, sir.
Sir?
Hello?
Sir, F1, F2, F3, FK are invariant factors of T. Reason. What is the reason for invariant factors of T?
Invariant means that means this will remain invariant, you see. That means you won't get, for a given operator, you won't be able to find any other polynomials with this property. Suppose, as I told you, that they are unique with this property. Right? They are unique with this property. If someone finds g1x, g2x, etc., gkx, with the property that gtx, then t and k will be equal, and there the property is the g1 divides g2, g2 divides g3 in this way, and gt will be the minimal polynomial, then t and k will be equal, and f1, g1 will be identical, f2, g2 will be identical, f3, g3 will be identical in this way, fk and gt will be identical, right? So this is the definition that in this case, these polynomials are called the invariant factors of t, right? Can you find any similarity with some other result? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Where can you find these types of result? Finitely generated abelian group.
Yes,
in the classification of finitely generated abelian group, right? There also you get the same term, the invariant factors, right? In fact, both are analogous, but both are coming from the same theory. That is coming from the structure theory of finitely generated module of our PID, right? Both are corollary, but this result and the similar result for finitely generated abelian group, they are the corollary to that result, corollary to the corresponding result for finitely generated abelian group for modules, PID, modules over PID, right? So for the time being, you call these to be invariant factors as a definition, okay? These polynomials are unique with this property, we are calling them invariant factors of the operator T, right?
Okay, sir.
Okay, and the last factor is the minimal polynomial. Some takes this in a different way, right? And this product of all the polynomials will be the characteristic polynomial. And if you take their companion matrices and put on the diagonals, and the block diagonal matrix we are getting here, that is called the rational canonical form of T. Right? Now for the matrix, the theory what we have discussed about canonical form of a linear operator in finite dimensional vector space is equally applicable for square matrices over a tree, right? Then you think in terms of LA only. And two matrices similar if and only if they have the same invariant factors. That means if and only if they have the same rational canonical form. Right? Here again, the one question may come that suppose you are getting two possible rational canonical forms of a matrix. Right? Does it mean that the rational canonical form of a matrix is not unique? No, not that. For a given matrix, there is only one rational canonical form. Right? Because this F1, Fx, F2, etc., Fk, they are unique for that matrix. So there will be a unique rational canonical form for a given matrix. But the problem is, if you do not know the matrix specifically, if you know some properties of that matrix, then you may not be able to find the exact rational canonical form. You can find some possible rational canonical forms. Right? So this is one important result you keep in mind to matrices similar if they have the same invariant factors. Now perhaps we can solve our problems. The problems I have raised there to motivate the lecture, you see, you come to the question. Question one. X square plus x plus 1 is an annihilating polynomial of A, right? So as a real polynomial, does it have any factor? No, it does not have any factor as a real polynomial. So as I told you that if you know an annihilating polynomial, you know minimal polynomials because a possible factors are the possible minimal polynomials. So since it does not have any factor over R, so the minimal polynomial of A is x square plus x plus 1, right? Now, what are the invariant factor decompositions? What is the form? It will be of this form, x square plus x plus 1 divides x square plus x plus 1 divides x square plus x plus 1. So their product will be of the form, the sum power of x square plus x plus 1, right? Now, for a 2 by 2 matrix of whatever be k, positive integer, greater or equal to 1, its degree will be even. Right? So for a 2 by 2 matrix, you know that if you take the product of the invariant factors, that will be the characteristic polynomial. For a 2 by 2 matrix, the degree of the characteristic polynomial is 2. So here k will be 1. Right? For question number 1, so the minimal polynomial, so you have been able to find the unique invariant factor decomposition of the given condition. It happens because of the order of the matrix, right? Because of the underlying field. So the invariant factor decomposition of A, I have written here as a question mark, you see. After this, what possible, right? I have already explained that because if you may not have sufficient information about the matrix, that's why you may not be able to find the exact rational canonical form or the exact invariant factor decomposition. You may find possible, but here the situation is such that you are able to find the exact invariant factor decomposition. That is x square plus x plus 1. So this is also the characteristic polynomial as I already explained. And for the question 1 and its companion matrix, this is the rational canonical form of the matrix. So 0 minus 1, 1 minus 1. So a 2 by 2 matrix satisfying the condition a square plus a plus I equal to 0, a 2 by 2 real matrix. For that, how many similarity classes are there? There is only one similarity class. And this is the most simple representative of that class. This is the rational canonical form of that matrix. And you see here that its determinant now you can find and its trace you can find. And any matrix belonging to the class of this is similar to that. These, so they will have the same determinant and same trace. So any 2 by 2 real matrix satisfying this a square plus a plus I equal to 0 will have determinant 1 and trace minus 1, right? So the question 1 is solved. Now for question 2, what happens? As I told you, whatever be k, the degree of this characteristic polynomial will be even. But for a 3x3 matrix, degree of the characteristic polynomial is 3. So there cannot exist any real matrix of order 3 satisfying a square plus a plus I equal to 0. That's why in the question I wrote there that if possible, if exists such a matrix, so there cannot exist a 3x3 real matrix satisfying this given condition, a square plus a plus I equal to 0. Right? Or in other words, having the minimal polynomial x square plus x plus 1. So am I clear? Hello?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. We have got
okay. Now, very strange, when the matrix will be complex, then what will happen? For question number 1, question number 2, etc. Now we come to question 3. When the order of the matrix is 4, then what are the possible invariant factor decompositions? It will be x square plus x plus 1 divides x square plus x plus 1. This is the only one. Isn't it? Here again, you have been able to find the exact invariant factors. So the rational canonical form, that means the companion matrix of this and this, if you put on the blocks, so it will be of this form. So again, there is only one similarity class. For the 4x4 real matrices satisfying the given condition. So now you can determine the determinant and trace. Now question, so this is all about the real matrices. Now you come to the complex matrices of order 2 satisfying these. In that case, you see the annihilating polynomial x square plus x plus 1, it can be factorized over C. Its factorization is x minus omega into x minus omega square. Right? So there are three possibilities for minimal polynomials. Minimal polynomial may be x square plus x plus 1. Minimal polynomial may be x minus omega. Minimal polynomial may be x minus omega square. Right? Accordingly, you see how many invariant factor decompositions you are getting. You are getting, this is one invariant factor decomposition, x minus omega divides x minus omega square divides x minus omega square. And another is x square plus x plus 1. So there are three, right? Now, what are the matrices? These are the rational canonical forms. So in this case, you are getting three possible cases. Well, here again, don't get confused. That means for a given matrix, you are getting three rational canonical forms. But because of the given conditions, you are not able to find the exact form. You are able to find only possible forms. Here are the possible forms. That means, the complex matrix 2x2 matrix satisfying a square plus a plus I equal to 0 can belong to this similarity class, can belong to the similarity class of this, can belong to the similarity class of this. That means you are getting three possible similarity classes, right? So you can find the, that means you will get three possible answers in this case. See the difference. Now, for question number 2, that means there cannot exist a 3x3 real matrix. If it is a complex case, then you are getting so many. See, look at this. If a minimal polynomial can be x minus omega, minimal polynomial can be x minus omega square, minimal polynomial can be x minus omega into x minus omega square. Right? So, what you are getting, these are the possible invariant factor decompositions. Okay? But why? Actually, what is this? X minus omega into x minus omega square is nothing but x square plus x plus 1, right? But make it clear, I have written this way for making it clear. And now the question is, there may be a confusion. Some can say that this is also, this one, for example, this one is also an invariant factor decomposition. But no, this is not. Why? Because in this case, the minimal polynomial is x minus omega whole square. But the annihilating polynomial is x square plus x plus 1. But x minus omega whole square is not a factor of x square plus x plus 1. Right? So x minus omega whole square cannot be the minimal polynomial. And for the similar region, x minus omega square whole square cannot be the minimal polynomial. So these two cannot be invariant factor decompositions. Right?
Sir, one question have arisen, sir.
Okay, which one?
I'm interrupting you. Sujan Mal is asking that how can you assure that degree of that product is equal to dimension of V?
Hello?
How can you? Sir, can you hear me? How can you assure that degree of that product is equal to dimension of V?
That is all about the theory. That is all about the proof of the theorem. Okay. That I have stated only the theorem. You see, you know that the product of the invariant factors is about the theory. That product of the invariant factors is the characteristic polynomial of the operator or the matrix. And you know degree of the characteristic polynomial and the dimension of the vector space are the same, right? So I think it is clear, but I am not talking about anything about the proof for this result. It's not possible also. Hello?
Okay, sir.
Okay. Now you see the strange difference. You see, when you are dealing with a 3x3 matrix, real matrix satisfying a given condition, you cannot find such a matrix, but there are many complex matrices, right? And in that case, you see, there is a chance of getting confused with these. Some can say that these are also invariant factor decompositions, but they cannot be because this is not a factor of the annihilating polynomial. So this cannot be the minimal polynomial. Similar reason, this cannot be the minimal polynomial. Now, when it is a 4x4 matrix, then what happens? The possible minimal polynomials will be x minus omega or x minus omega squared or their product, right? Okay. So I think I have repeated here this one. This last one is repeated here. The last two one are identical, you see. Okay. Because x minus omega into x minus omega squared is the same as x squared plus x plus 1, right? So here, apparently 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 6 possibilities are there, but actually there are 5 possibilities because the last two are identical, right? Is it clear? So you can yourself find it. These two are identical. So there are not 6, but there are 5 possibilities, right? I do not know whether it is getting recorded or not, but this is a mystery, you see. There will be 5 possible similarity classes, right?
Yes, sir.
And again, there is a chance of getting confused that these are possible invariant factors also, but the reason is that they cannot be the minimal polynomials. That's why they are excluded here. Okay. Now, what about that means we have talked about diagonalizability and the rational canonical forms. And what about Jordan canonical form, right? How to get Jordan canonical form? Rational canonical form, that means you are able to find rational canonical forms, whatever irrespective of the underlying field. That is very important. But for diagonalizability or for getting Jordan canonical forms, there is a restriction. What is the restriction? Diagonalizability, you have seen that the characteristic polynomial has to split into linear factors. But that is not a sufficient condition. That is necessary. But that is a sufficient condition for to getting Jordan canonical forms. That means if you have all the eigenvalues in the underlying field, then you can find Jordan canonical form. So we start with this invariant factors. If one, suppose these are the invariant factors, f1x, f2x, f3x, etc., fkx, right? Now, for such an invariant factor decomposition, if you see, we are going to define this, what do you mean by elementary divisors? So whether this minimal polynomial is a product of linear factors or not, we are not bothering about that. We can introduce this notion of elementary divisors. How? For such an invariant factor decomposition, there exist monic irreducible polynomials p1, p2, etc., ps with these properties. What? this minimal polynomial, that means the last factor, can be written as this product of the powers of products of the powers of PIs. That means MX is P1 to the power M1K, P2 to the power M2K, etc., PS to the power MSK. It's a look at these suffixes. See, we have S monic irreducible polynomials for this invariant factor decompositions with the properties that the minimal polynomial is the product of the powers of these PIs, and these powers, how they are written, you see, this one corresponds to the first suffix, two corresponds to the second first suffix here, and this corresponds to the first suffix here. And the second suffix, k, 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 etc., that corresponds to fk, right? Similarly, for f1x, p1 to the power m11, that means 1, this m11, the first suffix, is corresponding to this, the suffix of p. Similarly for this, and the second suffixes of mi's, they are coming from this fi, that means f1. Similarly, for the general case, fix will be p1 to the power m1i, p2 to the power m2i, ps to the power msi. Okay, I am giving you one example. From there, it will be clear to you. Anyway, but the point is, here these powers for the minimal polynomial, they are all non-zero. Suddenly positive, they are all non-zero. But for others, f1, etc., fi, for other invariant factors, what happens, they are not necessarily non-zero. They are greater or equal to zero, non-negative integers. Right? And in that case, this multiset of these powers of PIs, actually here this f1x, f2x, f3x, etc., fkx, they are not necessarily all distinct. Right? Here also, these PIs are distinct irreducible monic polynomials. But you see, when I consider this totality, that means the all possible such products for this f1, etc., fk, what happens, these multisets, right? Here, I am not sure that whether I have written it correctly or not. That is the task for Rajlokhi and Pavel to check it, that this multiset is correctly written or not. Multiset means that the elements are repeated here, right? So, this multiset, every member of this multiset is called an elementary divisor of the operator, right? Okay, let me give an example. Now, before coming to the example, you see here, if this minimal polynomial is a product of linear factors, then all the invariant factors will be product of linear factors. In that case, with the help of these elementary divisors, right, we will get the Jordan canonical form. How? Jordan canonical form of T is the block diagonal matrix of elementary Jordan matrices corresponding to the elementary divisors of T when the minimal polynomial is a product of linear factors. That means you take this case of a real matrix, say, so these, this is an invariant factor decomposition of a real matrix, x minus 2 into x minus 3 whole square divides x minus 2 into x minus 3 whole square into x plus 4 whole square divides x minus 2 into x minus 3 whole cube into x plus 4 whole square into x plus 5. You see, that means how many factors are there? 1, 2, 3, 4. That means f1 is this, product of x minus 2 and x minus 3 whole square. f2 is x minus 2 into x minus 3 whole square into x plus 4 whole square. f3 is this. F4 is this, I mean, this is the minimal polynomial. Now, what are the elementary divisors? What we have to do? You see, in the minimal polynomial, the irreducible monic polynomials are x minus 2, this is p1, x minus 3 is p2, x plus 4 is p3, x plus 5 is p4, right? Now, in other factors, you see, and we see in f3, you see, x plus 5 is there, x minus 2, x minus 3, x plus 4, x plus 5, all are there. But in F2, x plus 5 is missing. That means when we are writing here, x plus 5 whole to the power 0, we have to write here for F2. And for F3, we have to write x plus 4 whole to the power 0, x plus 5 whole to the power 0. Is it clear that I was telling you that except this minimal polynomial, when we write as the powers of PIs, then the powers are non-zero, positive integers for the minimal polynomial for all others, they may be zero, for some may be zero, as it happens here. For this F1, x power of x plus 4 is 0, power of x plus 5 is 0. For F2, power of x plus 5 is 0. Right? Now, how many x minus 2s and x minus powers of x minus 2s are there? In the first, you see there is x minus 2 only. In the second factor, x minus 2. In the third factor, x minus 2. In the fourth factor, x minus 2 whole square. So you take them separately, x minus 2, x minus 2, x minus 2, x minus 2 whole square. And for x minus 3, you see the first factor, x minus 3 whole square. Second, x minus 3 whole square. Third one, x minus 3 whole cube. And the fourth one, x minus 3 whole cube. Okay, in this way you write all of them. So these are all elementary divisors. So how many elementary divisors are there? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13. Okay? Then, corresponding to them, you write elementary Jordan matrices. Now, we have defined elementary Jordan matrices corresponding to a scalar. Right? And from there only, we can write the elementary Jordan matrices corresponding to these and put them on the blocks and make it a block diagonal matrix. That will be the Jordan form of the matrix whose invariant factors are these. So, for example, you see, just we are taking x minus 2 whole square, the elementary Jordan matrix corresponding to these is these. 2's on the principal diagonal, 1 on the super diagonal. And for x plus 5 whole cube, the elementary Jordan matrix will be of this form, minus 5 on the principal diagonal, 1, 1 on the super diagonal. So, this is the elementary Jordan matrix corresponding to these elementary divisors. Corresponding to all elementary divisors, you take the elementary Jordan matrices and put them as blocks on the on a matrix and get the block diagonal matrix. That is the Jordan canonical form of the matrix with invariant factors of these. Now, in the problems, what you see, suppose you are given a characteristic polynomial, you have to find all possible Jordan canonical forms because you do not know what is the minimal polynomial, then there are the possibilities. Even if you know the characteristic polynomial and the minimal polynomial, even then you may not be able to find the exact Jordan canonical form. You can find the possible Jordan canonical forms depending on the order of the matrix and other things, right? So that doesn't mean that a matrix can have more than one Jordan canonical form. A given a matrix has only one Jordan canonical form, and two matrices are similar if and only if they have the same Jordan canonical form. There we have seen that they are similar if and only if they have the same rational canonical form. Now the one can ask the question that in this case, when these minimal polynomial, this minimal polynomial is a product of linear factors, then can't we obtain rational canonical form? Yes. Here also we can find. How? Here in this case, instead of finding elementary divisors, you just multiply this x minus 2 into x minus 3 whole square, x minus 2 into x minus 3 whole square into x plus 4 whole square. In this way, you find f1x, f2x, f3x, f4x. Then you put their companion matrices on the block, and that will be the rational canonical form. Right? So, I think I have been able to discuss some facts about these canonical forms.
Sir, I have one question.
Yes?
Sir, actually, in the when we get elementary divisors and we put those in the Jordan, we put the
Jordan, elementary Jordan matrices corresponding to the elementary divisors.
Put there in the diagonal and we get the Jordan form. Now,
yes.
With respect to the elementary divisors, if we put their companion matrix in the block,
yes. That will also be a rational canonical form, but that is rational canonical form. In fact, there are two forms of rational canonical forms. One is corresponding to invariant factor decomposition. Another is corresponding to elementary divisors form, right? That is also a kind of rational canonical form. So there are two types of rational canonical forms. Okay, this is a very good question. Actually, one should know that if you take the elementary divisors and if you put the companion matrix instead of elementary Jordan matrices on the diagonal and make the construct the block diagonal matrix, that will also be a rational canonical form. But that form is known as rational canonical forms corresponding to elementary divisors. Right?
Okay, sir. Okay, sir.
And another thing I should say, actually, what is happening here, what we are getting, here the one problem is that corresponding to one basis, we are getting this form, whether it is Jordan form or it's a diagonal form or a rational canonical form, to find that basis is not so easy, you see. And ultimately, the whole space is broken up into some invariant subspaces, as it written as a direct sum of invariant subspaces, right? So this is the inside story. Actually, in the process, what we do, we just decompose the vector space over which we are talking about the linear operator into invariant into a direct sum of some invariant subspaces, right? If you, this is simply, if you think that suppose B is a direct sum of V1 and V2, right? V1 and V2 are invariant subspaces, invariant under the operator. Then if you find the, if you take the basis of V1 and V2 and string together with respect to that basis, you will get a block diagonal matrix. What is that block? What are those blocks? Two blocks. The blocks will be, if you, since the subspaces are invariant, if you restrict the operator to the subspaces, then the restrictions will be an operator from that subspace to that subspace. The invariance will give you that. And that means as if the operator is being decomposed, right? And that restriction, if you take the matrix of the restriction with respect to the basis of that subspace, and if you put on the blocks, then that will be the matrix of the original operator with respect to the basis obtained by stringing together the basis of the invariant subspaces. This thing is the main thing, what lies there in this theory. That means the objective is to find, objective is to decompose the vector space into direct sum of invariant subspaces, right? Ultimately, those invariant subspaces in terms of module theoretic terminology, they are cyclic subspaces, right? Okay, I like to have some questions.
Sir, okay, we have no question received in Google Meet chat box. Now, no, sir, in YouTube chat box, we also have no other questions. All the questions I have already asked to you.
There is no question?
No, there is no question unanswered. Sir, I have one request. You have half an hour more allotted. Sir, if you kindly, you have board, I'm seeing that. Kindly, sir, if you give the brief glimpse of the theory behind the invariant factor decomposition, I mean, if it is possible.
Okay.
We have time, that's why I'm asking you.
Okay, thank you. So, what happened?
Sir, I'm asking you to end this presentation. Okay. If you are doing something in board, then please end this presentation.
Now, can you, stop presenting?
Yeah, you have to stop presenting.
Okay,
sir.
Okay, all right.
What happened? Let me ask one question. Suppose. Can you see?
Sir, we are not. You are not audible, sir. You are visible, but you are not audible.
Just.
Hello?
Yes, now you are audible.
Yes, sir.
Can you see the board? Hello?
Yes.
Yes, sir, we can see the board.
Okay, here dimension. Right? Can you see the board? Hello? Hello?
Yes, sir. We can see it. We can see it.
Please make some larger fonts. Please make
larger. Okay. Larger. Oh. Okay. All right. See, the question is, does there exist a basis B such that a matrix is a block diagonal matrix? Right?
Okay.
Block diagonal matrix.
Yes, sir.
Now, how to answer this? This is the most important thing. If the blocks are of order 1, then this will be a diagonal matrix.
Okay.
Right?
Yeah.
Okay. Now, yes. how to get a basis, if it exists, that's you will get a block diagonal matrix with respect to that basis.
Okay.
So, what happens, say, suppose here you are getting 3 blocks, means you have decomposed, just a minute. You have decomposed suppose this is B1, B2, B3. So if you write this, right? So this and that means this VIs are invariant under T. This subspace B1, B2, B3, they are invariant subspaces under T. And their direct sum is the whole space. Now, if you take their basis B1, B2, B3, and if you string together, you call it D, then you see with respect to T, if you take the matrix, what it will be? Right? It will be of that form. How? You see, look at this. This is the most important thing. This is the most fundamental thing. How it is happening? Since these are invariant subspaces, V1, V2, V3 are invariant subspaces. If you restrict T to V1, I call it T1. Similarly, T2, T restricted to V2, T3, hello? Can you see? Okay. So T1, T2, T3 linear operators on V1, V2, and V3. Since they are invariant subspaces, so it is meaningful to say that V1 to V1, V2 to V2, V3 to V3. Now, if you take the matrices of T1, T2, and T3, T1, T2, and T3, so T1 with respect to B1, its basis is B1, its basis is B2, its basis is B3, then T2 with respect to B2, T3 with respect to B3, then this block diagonal matrix, this is the matrix of T with respect to B, where B is this. Here. That means then in that case you are getting a block diagonal matrix. So the what are the blocks? Blocks are the matrices of T1, T2, T3. That means they are the restrictions of T to these bases, B1, B2, B3 respectively. Right? So the idea is this, main idea is this, how to get sufficiently many invariant subspaces. Right? In case of diagonalizable operator, then what happens? In case of diagonalizable operator, what happens if you have lambda 1, etc., lambda k, these are the distinct eigenvalues. Right? And then e lambda 1, e lambda 2, etc., e lambda k, these are the eigenspaces.
Sir, then, I ask you to write some larger fonts there.
Hello?
It's audible and visible, but sir, if you kindly please make the font larger, then it will be more helpful.
Okay. These are the eigenspaces, right?
Okay, sir.
Okay, now all of you know that every eigenspace is invariant under the operator, right? Eigenspaces are invariant,
and they
form a direct sum. That means this is equal to right.
Okay, sir.
Yes, sir.
Now, if it happens that this is equal to B, then what happens? T becomes diagonalizable. Right? Is it clear?
Okay. Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, T becomes diagonalizable. But the point is that it may not happen always. This may not be equal to this. Then in that case, instead of eigenspaces, what we have to see, that means there is a shortfall. That means this, if you string together their bases, B1, B2, etc., BK, this B1, B2, BK, can you see the board? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir, we can see.
Okay, if these are the bases of the eigenspaces, then they are stringing together, this may not be the whole basis. Right, they may not be the this may not be the basis of the whole space. In that case, we have the problem, right?
Yes.
In that case, how to overcome that situation? That means instead of eigenspaces, we have to consider generalized eigenspaces like that. In that case, you see, primary decomposition theorem tells you one way how to get it, and all these are reduced to that finest form, that the result I have told you, that is for the rational canonical form. And there, what we do with the help of the operator T, V is made into an FX module. How V affects into V is made into an FX module in this way. right?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Then.
Yes, sir.
And since FX is a PID, then V becomes a module over PID. If dimension V is finite, then V becomes a finitely generated module over PID. V is a finitely generated module over the PID FX. Also, when dimension V is finite, it becomes a torsion module. Torsion module means, suppose you know the minimal polynomial. The minimal polynomial is such a polynomial that Mx is the minimal polynomial, then Mxb is zero for all V. Why? Because Mxb means empty V. Empty V means empty is zero. So zero V is zero. Right?
Yes, sir.
So V becomes a torsion Fx module. Torsion module over a PID, it has a structure in this way. Torsion module over a PID. N is a torsion module. Over a PID, right? Torsion module over a PID is a very nice structure. Then M is isomorphic to some cyclic modules. Hello? Can you see it? It's some cyclic modules, right?
Yes. So torsion module means?
Torsion module means, suppose you have an R module M. You think about, as if you consider this to be a vector field, then F module M means a vector space. In a vector space, you know, a scalar and vector, if you multiply, if it is zero, then this will be either alpha is zero or V is zero. But in a module, if you take RV or RM, RM is zero, this need not imply that R is zero or M is zero. Right?
Yes,
in
sir.
That case, if R is zero, then RM is zero. If suppose R is not equal to zero, M is not equal to zero, then but RM is zero, then M is called a torsion element. Right? M is called a torsion element. And torsion module means where all the elements are torsion elements. Zero is also a torsion element trivially, but for a non-zero element also, if you have such a non-zero element in the ring such that Rm is zero, then that element M is called a torsion element. And if all elements of a module are torsion elements, then M is called a torsion module. So because here you see, here Mxb is zero. Because
yes.
M, if this is the only element, it is making every element zero.
Yes.
So this finite dimensional vector space, if you consider an operator P on V.
Sir, I'm interrupting you once again. If you write at the bottom of the board, then it is not visible in YouTube. It is not visible. So the last line is not visible for the YouTube. Just the last line.
Okay. Just me. Is it okay? Just eat.
Yeah, it's okay, sir.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. So, if you then, if dimension B is finite, then V is a module, FX module via T, this becomes a torsion module. And torsion module has this torsion module finitely, M is a finitely generated, I'm sorry, finitely generated torsion module over PID, then M is isomorphic to this cyclic modules like this, right? Now, you see here the cyclic modules are, it can prove that this cyclic module, this is isomorphic to for some ideal I of R, right? Since this is a PID, this is a PID, this is the same as R by this, okay?
Yep.
Where this, is it clear? So this is a very important result you see. Any cyclic module is of this form. In fact, this ideal I is nothing but the annihilator of this, right? Annihilator of this cyclic module, right?
Okay.
Now, this ideal may have more than one generator. Now you just translate this problem for this V as an FX module, then V can be written as if you just translate this. In this case, what will happen? V as an FX module, is isomorphic to, say, V1, VK, like this. Now, V1 is, you see, V1 is isomorphic to Fx by, say, F1x, right? Like this, in this way, VK isomorphic to Fx, FKx, right?
Yes.
Now, you see, this, if F1x is generator of this ideal, then if you take any element alpha not equal to 0 from F, then alpha F1x and this F1x, they are the same. Got my point? Let me say a principal ideal may be generated by more than one element. You see, any associate of that will generate the same ideal. So the associates are precisely these, okay? But if you consider the monic generator of these ideals, the monic generators will be unique, right? The monic generators of unique, that means ultimately what happens, V is isomorphic to, Fx by F1x, Fx by F2x ... plus Fx by Fkx, right? Now, instead of any generator, if you take the monic generators, right, then this will be unique. So, another theorem for finitely generated torsion module over PID that says that such a decomposition for M exists like R by A1, R by A2, R by AK. Just general result for module, you see, finitely generated module, torsion module M over R, M is isomorphic to this. There is a result for module that this AIs are such that A1 divides A2, divides, etc. AK, right? Then these are called the invariant factors, right? Here there is no chance of this, they are unique, but they, if A1 divides A2, then any associate of A1 will also divide any associate of A2. There is no problem. So this thing you will get, but there is a result that this is unique with this property. That means this decomposition is unique with this property. These are called the invariant factors. There the invariant factors are not unique. They are unique up to associates. But here in this case of module, our vector space, when it is an apex module via T, these are unique with the property that F1x divides F2x, etc., FKx, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, there are some other theories that it can be proved that this is the minimal polynomial, right? This is the minimal polynomial and their product will be the characteristic polynomial, right? It can be proved. You have to work out, okay? Now, what is happening, the inside story I am telling you, you have heard the name of cyclic vector. So V belonging to V. So you can ask one question that those who are not acquainted with module theory, how to explain this? They have to study Hoffman and Kunz, but there you will see that Hoffman and Kunz, they are not using this term module, but all the terminologies are module theory. What they are calling that V belonging to V is called a cyclic vector. It's called a cyclic vector for T if V, TV, T square V, etc., TK V is a basis of V. Right? What does it mean? What does it mean in terms of module theory terminology? What is the meaning of this? Meaning is that means V itself, V as an FX module. V as an apex module is a cyclic module with V as a generator. Right?
Yes, sir.
Now you see, if you take the if you find the matrix of T with respect to the basis this, then what you'll get? You will get a companion matrix.
Yes,
sir. You will get the companion matrix of the this. You can check it yourself. You take the matrix of this, either the in which order you are writing. You are writing in this order or the reverse order. Accordingly, you will get the elements in the last column or in the last row and on the super diagonal or the sub diagonal, right? Now what we do, so when we say that D is isomorphic to Fx, this F1x, etc., and these are all cyclic modules, cyclic submodules of D, right? That means it's when these are all invariant also, right? Because you see, in module theoretic term, when we are making, hello,
yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
When we are making V as an FX module via T, what happens? The submodules are precisely the invariant subspaces, right? So these are submodules. So these are the invariant subspaces. Right, and these are cyclic modules, right? That's why if you take the basis of this and if you restrict T to this, then the matrix of that restriction with respect to the basis of this will be a companion matrix, right? And here this F1x, etc., FKx, when we find the companion matrices of these are the matrices of the restriction with respect to such types of basis, right? This is the inside story. This happens there, right? And putting on the diagonals, what you get? we define that to be the rational canonical forms. And these are invariant factors. Right?
Yes.
So in module theoretic terms, this can be explained. But many things to be, you have to work out more that to prove that this is the minimal polynomial and this product is the characteristic polynomial. Right? A good exposition, you can see that in Hungerford's book, you will be able to see in a very, two, three pages, they have explained nicely that how this is a minimal polynomial and how is this product is the characteristic polynomial. You can see the explanation there in Hungerford, right? Algebra. Right.
Okay, sir.
Decomposition of single linear transformations. Right?
Yes, sir.
Now, another thing just I want to this Jordan canonical form or this diagonalizability, there are most of the practical problems that when you apply these theories in solving differential equations, they are the operators, they are diagonalizable in most of the practical situations. That means that the situation is so nice, either it is diagonalizable or it has a Jordan form, Jordan canonical form. That means all the eigenvalues exist, right? There is a misconception when you say that lambda 1, etc., lambda k are distinct eigenvalues. It means that all the eigenvalues exist. But there is a problem, you see, suppose there is a matrix of order 4, real matrix. It has only two eigenvalues counting multiplicities. Is it possible to have such a matrix or not? Two. Hello?
Hello.
Ah. 4 by 4 real matrix. Having only. Hello.
Yes, sir, you are audible.
Having only 2 eigenvalues. Say 2, 3 counting multiplicities.
Okay.
Right. It doesn't mean that 2, 3 will repeat occur with multiplicities so that this algebraic multiplicity becomes 4, not there. So now you can find it, such a matrix, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Because just say you can construct a matrix like this and a companion matrix here you see 0, minus 1, minus 1, 1, 0, 0. Right. So most of the practical problems, the matrices or the operators are diagonalizable. And next best thing that even if they are not diagonalizable, then at least they have the Jordan canonical form. That means all the eigenvalues exist, not the situation like this. Here all the eigenvalues do not exist. Right.
Yes, sir.
Hello?
Yes, sir.
Hello. Yeah. Any other question? Aurobindo? Hello?
Sir, we have got one question in YouTube, like that section. I think he has got his answer, but I'm repeating the question. Molloy Pine asked that. what is the advantage of this isomorphism when you were decomposing G as the cyclic direct sum of cyclic modules? At that time, we asked the question, that is, what is the advantage of this isomorphism? But I think via your discussion, he has got your answer. Or
who has asked it? Sujon?
No, Molloy Fine.
Molloy Fine?
Yes.
So, Molloy, can you hear me? Hello? Molloy?
Molloy is not in Google Meet platform.
Oh, I see. I think you have got the answer, because you see, ultimately, the question starts from there. We are interested in decomposing the vector space into direct sum of invariant subspaces, right? And from there, everything starts from there. That means in that case, we will be able to find bases with respect to which the matrix will be a block diagonal matrix. And the blocks, when the blocks will be of order one, then it will be a diagonal matrix, right? If the blocks are elementary Jordan matrices, then it will be Jordan form. And if the blocks are companion matrices, then it will be rational canonical form, right? So diagonal matrix is the most nice thing, and the rational Jordan canonical form is the next best, and the rational canonical form is the next best, right? And the objective of decomposing the vector space into this invariant subspaces, this is the main objective. And then in the finer cases, to get such good representatives of the similarity classes, we need some more things like this, what I have discussed.
Sir, we have among us our IQC coordinator, who is also a well-known researcher in the field of economics.
Okay.
He posed a question long ago. I request Prithvi sir to ask the question yourself.
Okay.
Are you there?
Hello?
Hello?
Sir, actually, I am from economics background.
Okay.
So, I have a just query. Actually, due to heavy thunderstorm, probably you are not getting me properly. I have a question regarding this. So, when we use in economics, a lot of economic variable to relate with each other, and then we find certain relation between these variables, and we form matrix with the help of the coefficient, that relation. Then what is the interpretation of that matrix when you use the eigenvalue? What does eigenvalue actually interpret in terms of those economic variables when we relate?
Just a minute.
Probably, I am clear to you, but I suppose I am not that audible because of the thunderstorm is going on.
Hello?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Hello?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I'm getting you, sir.
Hello?
Sir, I am getting you, sir.
Okay. Just let me explain. So, suppose your system is this, right? See, this. Now this is the corresponding. Some noise is coming. Hello?
Yes, sir. Because of the thunderstorm that is going on. Heavy rain and thunderstorm.
Okay. Now, this is the corresponding homogeneous system, right?
Yes.
On the non-homogeneous system, you are talking about such linear systems, then what happens? As I told you, that you are... Okay, now it is okay. Fine. Now, you see, since you are talking about eigenvalues, etc., so your matrix is supposed to be a square matrix. And whether it is a square matrix or rectangular matrix, the one thing is that we are interested in the solution of this system. Now, how these eigenvalues are related with this solution? Perhaps this is your question. The thing is, if the matrix is, say, first thing you see, look here, just recall that there is a relationship between the set of solutions of these and the set of solutions of these. If you know one particular solution here, and if you know all the solutions here, then for any solution, if y is any solution here and a particular solution of this is a particular solution. Then, and y is any solution of this system, this is a particular solution of this, then y plus x0, this is a solution. Solution of this. Now the point is, see this, if A is diagonalizable, then what happens? Suppose A is diagonalizable, then you have a matrix like this, it is similar to a diagonal matrix. Say P inverse AP is a diagonal matrix. So if A is a diagonalizable matrix, then I think, and this diagonalization is very much related with the notion of eigenvalues, etc. Right? And if this is a diagonal matrix, then with the help of this, we can easily perhaps solve this system, and we can, it will be easier to solve, find the solutions of this system. Right? And in that case, if we know a particular solution, we'll be able to find the solution of this system. And this diagonalization, this eigenvalues, etc., these are responsible for this diagonalizability or this, say, canonical forms, etc. Not only this system of linear equations or system of linear differential equations also, there, these techniques, now, how this technique is used, that is available in the textbooks, you know, that everywhere, this, Jordan form or the diagonal form, they are related heavily there with the notion of eigenvalues, right? As I discussed here. Now, in computation, computational aspect, that eigenvalues, etc., there's the theory of eigenvalues, eigenvectors, they are very helpful to solve these types of problems. But if you ask me the physical connection, that means the eigenvalues, etc., what do they have with your parameters, etc., etc., that is known to me. And that if we want to relate it, then we have to understand the exact problem. The problem, the physical problem you have formulated as this system of equations. If that is specifically known, then perhaps one will be able to relate with the eigenvalues of the coefficient matrix with your physical parameters, right? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Otherwise, it is not possible to relate, but for computational aspect, in case of differential equations or these types of equations, this diagonalizability or those Jordan canonical forms, etc., those will help you solve these problems, right? Computation would be more easier. And this theory is based on this theory just of the eigenvalues and eigenvectors, right? But the point is, one thing I like to mention here, that without knowing the theories that what I have discussed, one can use the theory. But the problem just initially I started with, that problem can be solved, that I can make the student understand the working procedure, right, in 5 minutes. So that's a different thing. But what is the underlying theory to know these, it is also important, right? Some do not give importance on this underlying theory. They want to know the working procedure to solve problems, right? And the, there is a gap, that means we know some theories, but while applying, perhaps we will not be able to do that because we are not studying the differential equations, we are not applying there, etc., etc., right? Like your case. But there should be some collaboration. In that case, that will be meaningful. That means some people are applying without knowing the theory, and we people know some theory, but we are not applying anyway. That is a gap, right?
Exactly, sir. Thank you, sir. I
do not know how much you are satisfied with this, what question you have asked.
No, sir. I am enlightened by you, sir. A lot of things I came to know from you. But right now it is I don't have time, and you don't have also time, so that I can present a practical problem before you. So next time, sir, I am sure you will help me. In that case, and Dr. Rajlokhi Mukherjee is there. I can take her help also.
Okay, in the chat box, I can see some questions. Hello, Rajlokhi.
Sir, Shulata has asked two questions, and she in YouTube chat box that these questions have stuck in her mind from second year. So, get these answers.
Which one? যখন ধরুন এরকম কেস হলো যে মিনিমাল পলিনোমিয়ালটা এক্স স্কয়ার প্লাস ওয়ান হোল স্কোয়ার এক্স মাইনাস টু হোল টু দি পাওয়ার ফোর কি রেশনাল ক্যানোনিক্যাল ফর্মের সাথে কি জর্ডন ক্যানোনিক্যাল ফর্ম একসাথে থাকতে পারে মানে আমি এমন বেসিস পাবো না না নট দ্যাট নো 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 ইউ ওয়ান্ট গেট ইউ আর টকিং ইন রিয়েল ফিল্ড ইউ ওয়ান্ট গেট জর্ডন বেসিস ইউ উইল গেট অনলি রেশনাল ক্যানোনিক্যাল বেসিস বিকজ ইউ সি এক্স স্কোয়ার প্লাস ওয়ান ইজ নট ফ্যাক্টরাইজেবল দেয়ার Right? So if this is the minimal polynomial, then you have to find the invariant factors and you have to find the rational canonical form only. You won't get Jordan canonical form. Okay?
Form, we have to extend the field to complex, at least algebraically closed field, actually.
No, no, that's a different thing. But in this case, as you are telling that here it is implicit that x square plus 1 is not factorizable over the field, right? So suddenly she is talking about perhaps the field where it is not factorizable, x square plus one. There is the confusion she is having. And in that case, she is thinking that one linear factor is there, another is not non-linear, then whether that will be a mixed type something. No, no. You will get only rational canonical form. And another question is there. Hello? Hello?
My question is
that does there exist such basis like it is the union of B1 union B2 where B1 is a basis of this and B2 is any basis of this, N means null space, simultaneously Jordan basis. Oh, the same question you had.
Shulata has asked these two questions.
Oh, the same question, same question. Same question. That means she was asking about this. She was trying to elaborate this, right? The same question.
Yes.
No, no, no. It is not possible. You will get only rational canonical form, right? Jordan canonical form does not exist for this because the Jordan canonical form, the minimal polynomial has to split into linear factors, right? Hello?
Okay, sir. Yes, sir. We have no other questions left in the, and we have also reached 5:22 p.m. So I would like to end the session here. And one thing. Okay. Am I audible?
Yes.
Actually, it's always a privilege to get a chance to learn from you. So thanks for your valuable time in spite of all odds. And almost all the questions you have answered, and the YouTube chat box is floating with the comments that everyone is getting benefited. Everyone in the audience is getting benefited, and they are very much glad to have this session. And one thing I would like to ask you, sir. Some interested persons are asking for the PPT. Can you share, if it is possible, to share the PPT?
No problem. I can share it. No problem.
Okay, sir. Then I would like to request the interested participants, those who are interested to give the PPT, they can mail the organizers. Okay.
Ma'am, you can't audible.
Hello. I would like to request the audience.
Yes, audible.
Those who are interested to get the PPT, they can mail me. They can mail the organizers. Then we will try our best to reach you. So now I would like to announce the end of today's session. Thanks to sir again. Thanks to the organizers. Thanks to our principal sir, our head of the department, our ICC coordinator, and all the colleagues of the audience, and all my loving students for being with us for so long. So, sir, today's session ends here.
Okay.
Our session will start at 3 p.m. So, we will join
you. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you for your kind attention. Okay. I'm leaving now.
Okay, sir. So, we are ending our meeting here. Have a nice day. See you tomorrow.